We're live.
Thank you. Old Sergeant, will you start your recordings?
PC recording good.
Thank you.
Cloud recording started.
Thank you.
Backup is rolling.
Thank you. Sergeant Sadowski, you may begin with your opening statement.
Good morning, and welcome to today's remote New York City Council hearing of the Committee on Immigration. At this time, would all council members and council staff please turn on their video? To minimize disruption, please place electronic devices on vibrate or silent mode. If you wish to submit testimony, you may do so at testimony@council.nyc.gov. Once again, that is testimony@council.nyc.gov. Thank you, Chairman Chaka. We are ready to begin.
And buenos dias, everyone. Carlos Menchaca, Chair of the New York City Council's Committee on Immigration. I want to acknowledge that we have been joined by Council Members Drum, Chin, and Ku, and we are waiting for some of the other members to come in, and I will give them a shout out later in the committee hearing. Okay, great. So today, the Committee on Immigration will be conducting oversight on reducing barriers to citizenship. We will also be hearing my colleague, Councilmember Ku's resolution number 1229, which calls on the United States Congress to pass and the President to sign the Adoptee Citizenship Act of 2019 in order to secure U.S. citizenship of internationally adopted children who are now adults or aging into adulthood. I will let the co-sponsor, speak on his resolution and want to thank him for his commitment to this issue. It is a heartbreaking ordeal to go through, to be brought to the United States as a child, only to find out later that you are not guaranteed the rights of citizenship. And we must have the immigration law updated immediately to ensure this does not happen. The right to attain citizenship is a sacred tenet of our nation's foundational documents, which it comes to the privilege of voting and running for office, but also the permanent protection from deportation and the freedom to travel within and outside the United States. Citizenship allows individuals full access to this nation's safety net, benefits without fear of adverse immigration consequences. In New York, more than half of our 3.1 million immigrant neighbors are naturalized citizens. The Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs estimated in 2019 that another 622,000 immigrant New Yorkers could be potentially eligible for citizenship. We are living in a new era under new federal leadership, and we are grateful for that. And yet we cannot ignore the carnage that is wrought across our immigration system, harming too many lives over the last 4 years. We have a mandate to do better. And as chair of the Immigration Committee, today is about calling attention to the ways in which the federal government has failed our immigrant communities and must immediately take action to change the course. We are excited that a pathway to citizenship is among President Biden's top priorities. And I want to make sure to thank our congressional representative, Nidia Velasquez, for her persistent advocacy and leadership on this issue. New legislation being proposed by the White House would offer a pathway to citizenship for all immigrants living in the United States as of January 1, 2021, and meeting certain criteria. This will ultimately increase those New Yorkers who may become eligible for citizenship. The mayor's office estimates that there were approximately 504,000 undocumented immigrants in 2018, and many of them could be newly eligible for naturalization under new federal legislation. At the same time, the chilling effect that the xenophobic and cruel former federal administration has furthered the active pursuit of policies that would erect barriers to accessing citizenship and the rapid spread of COVID-19 have left our naturalization processes under-resourced and overburdened. At the end of 2019, federal fiscal year, there was a naturalization backlog of 644,000, with a potential additional 130,000 cases backlogged due to suspension of most in-person citizenship processes. And this is all in 2020. We have a formidable task ahead to assist our many New Yorkers with the process of naturalization. And I look forward to hearing from our colleagues in the mayor's office about the work they have continued to do to ensure the barriers to citizenship are reduced as much as possible. To the providers, including our friends at CUNY Citizenship Now, who have continued to work throughout the last 4 years, but especially in this last year, with resources further limited and the necessity of digital creativity, we say thank you. We are here because of your unwavering commitment to immigrant New Yorkers, and we know that you will rise to the challenge ahead. I want to thank the administration and service providers for testifying today, as well as the staff working behind the scenes, making sure that the online hearing runs smoothly. These things are not easy, so thank you. I also want to thank Immigration Committee staff for their work on this issue, Committee Counsel Harbani Ahuja, Policy Analyst Elizabeth Kronk, and my staff as well, Chief of Staff Lorena Lucero and Cesar Vargas. And before I hand it over to my colleague, Councilmember Koo, I just want to give a moment for us to remember all those that have died, the immigrant New Yorkers, who have been essential workers and that have carried so much of the burden to keep the city moving. We think about them as we think about citizenship, as we think about the path to a better life here, not just in our city, in our state, but in our country. And with that, I want to turn it over to Councilmember Koo for remarks on his resolution. Councilmember Koo?
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Chair, for hearing my resolution today, 1229. Hello? Can you hear me?
We can hear you. We got you. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So let me start over. Thank you, Chair, for hearing my resolution today, Resol 1229. I introduced this resolution a year ago, calling on the federal government to close a loophole in the Child Citizenship Act of 2000, which prevents internationally adopted children from receiving U.S. citizenship, despite being legally adopted by U.S. citizens. Imagine spending 99% of your life as an American, only to have your country turned its back on you because of missing paperwork. The Child Citizenship Act of 2000 was supposed to allow foreign-born children of U.S. citizens to acquire citizenship. Unfortunately, a loophole in the act left out thousands of adoptees from countries all over the world because they were 18 years old by the time the law went into effect. Thousands of international adoptees have spent nearly their entire lives in America without citizenship rights, and many actually have no idea they are not really citizens. Such an oversight is a colossal failure of our federal immigration policy. You should be prioritized as an urgent notion why international adoptees should not be granted full and unequivocal citizenship. Last week, we celebrated Korean American Day, marking 7 years as I introduced legislation to name January 13 after the first arrival of Korean immigrants to the United States in 1903. The day also marked 1 year since I introduced this resolution alongside many advocates and immigration groups at City Hall. An overwhelming number of adoptees affected by this policy are Korean American adoptees. We have spent too long demonizing immigrants in this country. These are our family members, our friends, and our neighbors. It's time that we treat them with the basic human dignity that they deserve. Chair.
Councilmember Koo, you may have. Did you complete your remarks?
Yes. Did you hear me?
Okay. Yes. Thank you. I just wanted to just make sure if there was something else you wanted to add. But thank you so much for your resolution today, and for your commitment to this issue. And I wanted to say thank you to you. And we've also been joined by Councilmember Moya, who is here and on the committee. I want to hand it over to the committee counsel, Arbani Ahuja, to go over some procedural items to get us started with our first panel, our public panel.
Thank you, Chair. My name is Arbani Ahuja, and I'm counsel to the Committee on Immigration for the New York City Council. Before we begin, I want to remind everyone that you will be on mute until you are called on to testify, when you will be unmuted by the host. I will be calling on panelists to testify. Please listen for your name to be called. I will be periodically announcing who the next panelist will be. For everyone testifying today, please note that there may be a few seconds of delay before you are unmuted, and we thank you in advance for your patience. All hearing participants should submit written testimony to testimony@council.nyc.gov. At today's hearing, the first panel will consist of members of the public, followed by representatives from the administration, followed by council member questions, and then additional members of the public will testify. I'd like to remind everyone that unlike our typical council hearings, we will be calling on individuals one by one to testify, and each panelist will be given 3 minutes to speak. For panelists, once your name is called, a member of our staff will unmute you, and the sergeant at arms will give you the go-ahead to begin upon setting the timer. Please wait for the sergeant to announce that you may begin before delivering your testimony. Council members who have questions for a particular panelist should use the raised hand function in Zoom, and I will call on you after the panelist has completed their testimony. We will now hear testimony from our first panel. I'd like to welcome Farhana Chaudhry to testify. After Farhana Chaudhry, I will be calling on Ileana Diaz to testify. Farhana Chaudhry, you may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Thank you, Chairman Menchaca, and the members of the Committee on Immigration for allowing me this opportunity to speak at this hearing today. I delayed my application for my citizenship because I heard the cost of the legal and application fees would run upwards of thousands of dollars. And as a student with little means, I certainly could not afford that. Then in 2018, I was ecstatic to learn about the CUNY Citizenship City Council Program's free immigration services. I was so excited that I showed up an hour early for my appointment, which is very uncommon of me. But however, I was still pretty anxious about covering the citizenship application fee. Then during the intake process, Ellie, the incredibly intelligent woman who helped me with my application, said the two most beautiful words that brought tears to my eyes: fee waiver. As a student living on ramen noodles, this was a huge burden lifted on my shoulder. I hugged Ellie out of sheer excitement, although I wouldn't really recommend it at this present time. CUNY Citizenship Now has not only helped me, but it has also helped my brother become citizens of this great nation. My father is also currently in the process of applying for his citizenship. My father's case is a bit more complicated, and he was unsure if he could even apply. CUNY has helped him obtain all the necessary paperwork in order for him to proceed with his case. I'm eternally grateful for the CUNY Citizenship City Council Service Program, so much so that I became a volunteer with CUNY Citizenship Now, and I will continue to do so for years to come. I want to make sure that I was able to share the knowledge that I gained from CUNY and other, gain the knowledge and share with others, other immigrants. Because of this amazing program, I was able to vote on November 2020, which is likely one of the most significant elections of my time, of my lifetime. Thank you again, City Council, for allowing me this opportunity to speak today.
Thank you so much for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Ileana Diaz to testify. Ileana Diaz will be accompanied by Cesar Vargas, who will be providing Spanish interpretation. Ileana, you may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Hola, Ileana. ¿Puede empezar y puedes empezar y después unas partes de su testimonio? Yo le voy a traducir para los concejales y el público.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, NYC council members, for letting me be here to share my experience about the process of my citizenship. First, I'd like to mention that I was a proud volunteer in CUNY Citizenship Now. My friend Joseph Lebesky told me about the CUNY Citizenship Now organization, and he invited me to become a volunteer. So I did it for 2 years, from 2016 to 2018, filling out the citizenship application, especially to people who speak Spanish. But then I started working on Saturdays, and for that reason, I couldn't continue volunteering. I got my residence in August 2013 due to the petition of my mother. I applied for the citizenship with fee waiver because I have Medicaid. It was on May 30, 2018. And then I had my appointment for the interview on June 2019 in New Jersey, in Newark. And finally, the ceremony was 1 month later on July 25th. When I received my schedule for the appointment, I was a little surprised because it was in New Jersey and not in New York where I applied, because I was living in Brooklyn. My appointment was at 1 p.m. and I was planning to leave home very early because I had to be there 1 hour earlier and I didn't want to get lost. So I was worried because I don't have a car and I didn't want to be late. Fortunately, Joseph helped me in this process because I filled out my forms of application, but he read all the information to check and put the signature. I told him that my appointment was in New Jersey, and he offered me to take me there. And also, he was representing me while I was with the interviewer. Even though the place of my appointment was far from my house, the experience was wonderful because I became American and I felt supported by Joseph in all the process. So the day of ceremony was easier.
Time expired.
The day of ceremony was easier because I was in the United States of Courthouse in Brooklyn. So the time only I had to take a bus because it was close to my area. The ceremony was really good, but I didn't receive my little American flag. I asked about that, but they told me that they didn't have, so I vote one later.
Thank you, Ms. Diaz. Thank you for your story today.
Thank you.
And your testimony.
Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I'll now turn it over to council member questions, starting with Chairman Chaka.
So my only question, and we're gonna be hearing from the mayor's office, and we have a lot of council members here today, and we'll be talking to a lot more council members. When Biden came out with his, what we felt was an affirmation for a path to citizenship, what do you feel like the most important thing that the city can do to make lives better for anyone who's going to be applying for citizenship? And I just wanted to give Ms. Diaz or Ms. Chaudhary an opportunity to talk about what the city council needs to hear right now and the mayor needs to hear right now.
Señor Díaz, ¿quiere que le... Ok. El concejal dice que dijo que aparte de su programa y el proceso, ¿cuáles cosas usted cree que la ciudad pueda hacer para mejorar el proceso, particularmente con todo lo que está pasando de las tarifas, pero también del proceso legal? ¿Cuáles cosas que usted cree puede hacer el proceso más fácil que la ciudad de Nueva York pueda hacer, que pueda ayudar a muchos inmigrantes?
Ok, yo pienso que el fee waiver debería continuar porque hay muchas personas que no ganan lo suficiente como para pagar la tarifa actual. Creo que la subieron a 1,075, me parece, y hay personas que eso es lo que ganan en un mes. Entonces, pienso que sería una gran ayuda que continuara el fee waiver. Sería una gran ayuda para las personas que están aplicando a la ciudadanía. Por otro lado, también, si los appointments para las entrevistas son más cerca del área donde vive la persona, también sería una gran ayuda porque, por ejemplo, mi appointment fue en New Jersey, fue muy lejos. Yo tuve que salir muy temprano de mi casa para llegar a tiempo, para no perderme en el camino, porque nunca había ido a ese lugar. Y creo que tienen que estar más organizados en ese aspecto.
Muchas gracias por la respuesta de la pregunta. And Ms. Chaudhary, do you want to say anything else about what you think is the most important thing for us to hear right now?
Council member, can I translate for Ms. Diaz?
Absolutely.
I apologize. Ms. Diaz testified that one of the things that could be helpful for immigrants to have an easier process to citizenship is to continue the fee waiver that allows many people who don't have the necessary funds to get the citizenship. Sometimes the fee is more than what people make, more immigrants that make in a month. So it's sometimes out of reach to pay for that fee. Another thing that the citizenship process could make it easier for immigrants is to hold the interviews, the process where you actually do the civic exams, is to hold it closer to where the person lives. Ms. Diaz testified that she went all the way to New Jersey and had to get up really early and go through many different types of transportation to get there, and it made it more difficult. So those two are the things that would make it easier for immigrants to have an easier process to become citizens.
Hi. So I completely agree with Ms. Diaz. Like, the fee waiver is very crucial. Like, that was one of the main deterrent for me even applying. So when I found out that I didn't have to pay and it was that much easier, it made the process so much accessible. So I feel that to continue this, it would definitely get a lot of people to step up and then go through with their application. And also maybe spreading the word of the CUNY citizenship. Like, I think just getting the word out there and what they're doing and just, you know, I think spreading the word in the community, I think that would, that's my suggestion. But other than that, yeah, I think they're doing a fantastic job. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you again. I am done with questions. I'll hand it back to committee council.
Thank you, Chair. I'd like to ask if any other council member questions, if there are any other council member questions at this time. Seeing no hands, I'm going to thank this panel for their testimony, and we will now be hearing from members of the administration. I will now call on members of the administration to testify. Testimony will be provided by Moya Commissioner Bita Mustafi. Additionally, the following representatives will be available for answering questions: Yasmin Farhang, Senior Advisor for Legal Initiatives at MOIA. As a reminder, during the hearing, if council members would like to ask a question of the administration or of a particular panelist, please use the Zoom raise hand function and I will call on you in order. Before we begin, I would like to administer the oath. Commissioner Mostafi, Yasmin Farhang, I will be calling on each of you individually for a response. Please raise your right hands. Do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in your testimony before this committee and to respond honestly to council member questions? Commissioner Mostafi?
I do.
Thank you. Yasmin Farhang?
I do.
Thank you. Commissioner Mostafi, you may begin your testimony when you are ready.
Thank you and good morning. Thank you to Chairman Chaka and members of the Committee on Immigration and to Farahana and Ileana for sharing your stories. I'm Bita Mostafi. I'm the Commissioner for the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs. And recognizing the many benefits that spring from citizenship, including the economic benefits to the person becoming a citizen in their community, we at MOIA and the city have worked to help create access to citizenship for New Yorkers, and I'm excited to talk about that work today. And in my testimony, I will also discuss the benefits of naturalization, the barriers facing immigrants who wish to naturalize, and how we've worked to reduce those barriers. Naturalization, or the process of becoming a citizen, has been an integral part of our work in the past few years. The population of lawful permanent residents or green card holders who are eligible to naturalize in our city is significant. We estimate that about 622,000 New Yorkers are potentially eligible to naturalize. Citizenship and naturalization process reflect our American values of inclusion and civic engagement. How we structure the process of citizenship speaks volumes about what kind of country we want to be. And as such, MOIA and the city have consistently worked to ensure that naturalization be as accessible as possible for those who qualify. In addition, the city has long recognized the benefits that accrue to naturalized New Yorkers and the city when immigrants become citizens. First, naturalization provides economic benefits for the person who naturalizes. Naturalized citizens earn about 9% more a year than those who are eligible to naturalize but remain non-citizens. Naturalized citizens also are more likely to be employed and own a home than green card holders. Naturalization is a crucial tool for fighting poverty. An analysis of New York City's immigrant population shows that the poverty rate of naturalized New Yorkers is 7% lower than those of lawful permanent residents. Second, when immigrants become citizens, it provides economic benefits for our communities. Part of this benefit comes from the increase in earnings that they receive, which lead to higher tax revenues. In the aggregate, if all eligible to naturalize immigrants in New York City were to become citizens, annual city, state, and federal tax revenue would rise by $789 million, and public benefits cost would decrease by $34 million, for a net benefit of $823 million a year. Third, naturalization helps strengthen our community's civic bonds. Through citizenship, immigrants are more directly connected to civic and community participation. Citizens can vote in city, state, and federal elections. They can run for city, state, and federal elected offices. Studies also show that the economic benefits of citizenship, especially increased income and home ownership, lead to higher rates of participation in civic organizations and volunteer activities. Despite these myriad benefits, less than 10% of those who are eligible to naturalize in our city do so every year. There are long-standing barriers to becoming naturalized, including the relatively high cost of naturalization and language barriers. MOIA's analysis of the eligible to naturalize population found that about 45% of eligible New Yorkers are low income, meaning below 200% of the federal poverty level, and that about 59% have limited English proficiency. Unfortunately, these barriers have been compounded by the last 4 years of actions of the Trump administration, which actively and openly hostile to the idea of a welcoming and inclusive America. the administration sought to discourage and impede naturalization at every turn. First, the administration proposed a rule targeting lawful permanent residents with disabilities, impeding them from obtaining a medical exemption to the citizenship testing requirement. Second, the administration sought to make the requisite civics exam longer and harder in an effort that was politicized in nature. And they sought to institute a de facto wealth test to citizenship by eliminating the fee waiver and disproportionately raising the application fee. The fee schedule that they sought to enact would have increased the cost of naturalization by an unprecedented 83%, increasing the already high cost of $640 to over $1,000 and imposing an insurmountable challenge to many families. Finally, the Trump administration showed their contempt for naturalization even during the COVID-19 crises by halting oath ceremonies for naturalization and refusing to institute remote ceremonies, despite having the authority to do so and repeated calls from bipartisan lawmakers, in effect, delaying the naturalization of over 100,000 permanent residents around the country in advance of an election. Given these actions, it is no surprise that under the Trump administration, naturalization process has slowed to a crawl. As of this month, the processing time for naturalization applications at USCIS's New York City field office ranges from 16 and a half to 23 months. The city has consistently worked to encourage naturalization, not just in our city, but across the country. As chair of the Cities for Citizenship, along with mayors of Chicago and Los Angeles, we have worked with the coalition for years, drawing on experiences of multiple jurisdictions to make the case for national investments in citizenship. Prior to the Trump administration, New York City also worked closely with the Federal Task Force for New Americans to raise awareness about citizenship and the benefits of naturalization, especially during Citizenship Day. In 2015, for instance, Mayor de Blasio welcomed 100 new citizens in a citizenship naturalization ceremony. City libraries also have ongoing partnerships with USCIS to hold New American Corners, which are dedicated spaces in libraries that hold information about citizenships and immigration issues more generally. The Trump administration's attempts to make naturalization beyond the reach of many lawful permanent residents fundamentally conflicts with the longstanding goals we have as a city to encourage it. For this reason, Moya has shown leadership in fighting back against actual and proposed changes in a variety of ways. First, by submitting comments in opposition to proposed rules, including comments opposing the changes to disability exemptions and the new fee schedule. Second, by leading on multi-city letters, both opposing the dramatic increase in naturalization fees, and most recently in calling for remote oath ceremonies during the pandemic. And third, by leading and coordinating a multi-city amicus brief in support of enjoining the changes to the USCIS fee schedule. This, we are pleased to share, supported a lawsuit which ultimately stopped implementation of the entire rule nationwide, and with the judge in that case citing to the amicus brief that we submitted as evidence for the national effects of the rule. Moya's work with fellow cities and counties across the country took place with our leadership in two coalitions, Cities for Citizenship, which I mentioned, and Cities for Action, where we have been able to highlight both the local and the national interests at stake, gather with sister municipalities to share strategies about how to continue supporting our residents and celebrate Citizenship Day by encouraging eligible New Yorkers to naturalize. We believe that the Biden administration sees the value in supporting naturalization as the Obama administration did. We have been communicating closely with the incoming administration, including on issues related to naturalization. Our hope is that the Biden administration will roll back the barriers erected by the Trump administration and furthermore take steps to increase investments in promoting citizenship and immigrant civic participation generally. We have also asked for, and the new administration has committed to, a day one bill that provides dedicated funding to cities and counties, as well as libraries, labor unions, employers, colleges and universities, and other partners to expand programs to promote integration and inclusion increased English language instruction, and provide assistance to individuals seeking to become citizens. Finally, our belief in the power of naturalization is also reflected in our investment in legal services. Together with the New York City Council, the City of New York invested tens of millions of dollars in immigration legal services. Since July 1st of 2016, Action NYC and other city-funded legal services programs have assisted low-income and other vulnerable immigrants in over 5,000 naturalization applications. From 2016 to 2020, Moya also partnered with the Human Resources Administration, the Public Library System, and the New York Legal Assistance Group and private funders to implement NY citizenship, a legal services program focused specifically on naturalization, which has now been built upon and incorporated into the Action NYC program as Action NYC in libraries, as well as a continued effort at HRA. Furthermore, we continue with funding that addresses some of the most vulnerable lawful permanent residents' need for access to naturalization and to ensure continuation of legal representation in cases that have been delayed due to the pandemic. We further, in response to the COVID-19 pandemic and the economic challenges that many New Yorkers faced, in the spring developed a fee fund for New Yorkers to allow them to support their applications, naturalization being one of the many applications that would qualify. I'm proud to say that these legal services have helped many clients, including senior clients who have longtime green card holders, finally naturalize. One client who received directed outreach from the program had been a lawful permanent resident for almost two decades. She previously tried to apply for citizenship, but gave up after difficulty finding all of her documents. With the help of the legal services providers, she became a citizen in June of last year. Another client from Trinidad and Tobago had a green card for over 40 years and decided that this was the time to become a citizen. And with help from our programs, she applied for naturalization in June of 2018 and became a citizen in March. And as I conclude my testimony, I just want to take a moment to acknowledge that naturalization process is just a microcosm of the immigration experience. It often is needlessly bureaucratic, expensive, and difficult, but it is also beautiful. Through naturalization, people from all over the world with stories as varied as they can be transform into one nation. That's an ideal certainly worth fighting for. Thank you again to the Committee on Immigration for calling this important hearing, and I look forward to taking your questions.
Thank you for your testimony, Commissioner. I will now turn it over to questions from Chairman Chaka. Panelists, please stay unmuted if possible during this question and answer period. Thank you. Chairman Chaka, please begin.
Thank you. And I want to say thank you to Commissioner Mustofi for being here with your team and really joining us in this larger conversation as we look at this next chapter of federal policy that's on its way. New York City has a big role to play in how we engage as a willing partner and a partner that has been committed to this larger struggle of building a sanctuary city. And so I just want to say thank you to that commitment and everything that you and your team have done during COVID. We can't say it enough. I think any opportunity that we have to say thank you to that service must be done. So thank you. And really with that, as we really anticipate the transition from the over and with very xenophobic fuel under the Trump administration, things became more complex. And so how did these policies, and I'm really looking at things like the average time it took for legal service providers to complete a case, that is something that I think we have been in joint effort funding for New Yorkers. How did these policies affect the average time it took for our legal service providers to complete a case?
Sure, I will start and then invite Yasmin to share more as to sort of the specifics. It was and certainly continues to be at this moment a challenging legal landscape for our providers who are serving immigrant New Yorkers. As I noted, the huge increase in backlogs and waiting times, on average, anything from 16 and a half to 23 months of waiting. And that means that your case is pending during this period of time. There was a myriad additional policies that USCIS lifted up across the board that made sort of the adjudication of what once may have been very straightforward and simple applications more bureaucratic in nature. And so certainly we've recognized with, along with our providers, that that means an extended period of time that cases remain open, that means greater challenges in coming to completion or closing out cases, and perhaps additional legal efforts like replying to what might be a request for evidence, or additional sort of back and forth that might come from the immigration service. And we did work in coalition and continue to with Cities for Citizenship in particular on a campaign called The Second Wall, recognizing that all of the efforts that were brought to reduce access to citizenship really fundamentally were like the erection of another wall in the immigration system. And so we will continue to focus on those efforts at reducing those barriers, breaking them down, but also looking forward to making the process more accessible for everyone. Yasmeen, do you want to add specifics on the experiences of providers?
Thank you, Commissioner.
Clients with fee waivers, which is obviously critical in the naturalization context, that one of the barriers under COVID in particular was the clients were unable to get the proof that they needed to qualify for those fee waivers. So, you know, one of the most critical paths to qualifying for a fee waiver is demonstrating that the applicant receives a means-tested benefit, such as Medicaid. Previously, the way that you know, the clients of so many legal service providers would be obtaining that was by going in person to obtain those proofs, or requesting them by mail. So, you know, that's one example of sort of a proof that was much more onerous for folks to obtain during COVID. And so at Moya, we actually worked with HRA to come up with a streamlined system for applicants and their legal representatives to be able to get those electronically to try to address the additional delay that applicants were facing in filing their naturalization applications. So we really had to, you know, work with partners and think creatively about ways that the, you know, additional delay that was being caused by COVID and the inability to get those critical documents could be made more accessible.
And I guess so you're kind of really looking at the, and you're kind of exposing the hurdles. Do you have a sense of timing, like how the legal service providers were, was there any kind of data just on how long it took and the just the impacts of the local service providers?
So from March to June, the USCIS field office had suspended all in-person activities, including the application, the interviews, as well as the oath ceremonies, some of the advocacy that Commissioner Mostafi spoke to was how to overcome some of the unnecessary cases that were in limbo during that time, such as advocating for remote oath ceremonies. Once they reopened, they did so extremely gradually, in part due to social distancing protocol at the local office. So those delays significantly continued. The number of people who were able to go for their in-person interviews and for their oath ceremonies was really a fraction of what it should have been. We don't have those numbers in front of us of how many it was in comparison to how much it would normally be, but could get that.
Okay, thank you. And so let's move on to a couple more questions, and I'm gonna hand it over to my colleagues before I finish off with another round. But the just thinking about the annual report, the 2019 annual report, is Moya conducting outreach to these individuals to inform them of their ability to naturalize and the city services they may use to complete that process?
Sure, I can start. We have, we do and conduct outreach in a number of ways. I think notably on the front of the citizenship specific efforts, we have two that are really dedicated and intentional for naturalization. One is through our library system that will not change. We have supported the library system in having outreach, an outreached effort in each system that is able to do intentional and targeted outreach related to citizenship or including citizenship to ensure that as people are coming through the libraries or receiving information about library services, included in that is naturalization and citizenship access. And so that's something that is ongoing and is a part of our continued efforts to support the library systems in doing that work. Additionally, we have worked intentionally, as I said, with the Human Resources Administration to establish the NY citizenship work that really is designed to reach the most vulnerable immigrant New Yorkers who are eligible to naturalize. And that includes the dedication of a staff member who does affirmative outreach to HRA clients that are believed to be eligible for naturalization. They do so through letters, they do so through telephone calls. So really intentional and individual outreach with HRA clients to bring them into and connect them to naturalization services. And then additionally, as part of our work more broadly as an agency, we include immigration legal services, including naturalization, in all of the virtual engagement that we do and on the ground engagement when we're able in letting folks know about what's available to them. That's also included in the Know Your Rights programming that our community-based providers do that the city funds and supports. So there's a lot of different channels that we utilize for on the ground and direct outreach and engagement, including very hyper individualized engagement for people who we know are eligible, in addition to sort of the more macro level work that we do every year celebrating Citizenship Day with a series of digital sometimes ads. We've done partnerships with Link NYC on this. I have attended an oath ceremony to amplify the importance, as has Mayor de Blasio. We have additionally written op-eds and ensured that we are communicating through as many channels as we can about the ability to naturalize and the ways in which city-funded resources can be utilized for that purpose.
And Commissioner, this is a really robust operation, and I think we're very familiar with it in Sunset Park because I think we partner up on a lot of these, and even just today, for example, the St. Michael's spot is opened, and we want to say thank you again for that incredible focus on the IDNYC Center, just because these are really tough times to engage and. And we're all trying to figure out how to be safe during COVID. And you mentioned libraries, which have been closed most of the last year as another spot for communication. And so I guess I just want to follow up on that as you referenced libraries and we're struggling to really reopen IDNYC spots for more enrollment. This is going to be a big issue. And so I just wanted to kind of get a sense about how Moya is really retooling in a time of COVID to ensure that we can keep up with the pace of engagement.
Sure. So in terms of citizenship, the libraries have, as many folks have, retooled, as you said, to ensure that they're doing digital outreach and engagement to New Yorkers. And so I think certainly from our perspective as the funder here, we are trying to be flexible and acknowledge the difficulty of the moment and the challenges that are faced. We want all of the workers to be safe in the work that they are undertaking. So we have been very sort of open to all of the alternative methods of communication outreach and engagement that can be undertaken in a moment in which, as you rightly know, there isn't such ready access to the physical locations. As of January 1st, I'm very happy to report that our new Action NYC in Libraries programming began. And that is happening at this moment. So the outreach is happening by the library systems, and the provider is able to take continue to take cases with a virtual or initial phone intake, and then follow up as needed.
Okay, let's keep lines open on that. I think I'm thinking about some of the projects we joined efforts in big and small ways, like working with mutual aid organizations, mm-hmm. other places where people are going to,
yep.
so that we can bring good information and build out infrastructure and support that infrastructure. So let's go offline on some of those ideas. We're very interested in this new proposal, which is my second question, this new proposal to extend a pathway to citizenship for all undocumented individuals living in the US as of January 1st, 2021. How many New Yorkers does Moya believe to be estimated that could be eligible for this citizenship, and how soon?
Yeah, I certainly want to start by saying how incredibly exciting it is to see this proposal on day one of the Biden administration, and a commitment that is very well earned by so many who have been advocating for and really fighting for the inclusion of our communities in our immigration system. And so, you know, we're incredibly excited about this. As I know, we have engaged already with the Biden team, first through the transition team, and now continuing conversations in the new administration, and we will continue to do that. We, as we have estimated in the past, believe approximately 500,000 New Yorkers are undocumented. And that estimate includes individuals who lack a path to permanent status. So it's inclusive of our Dreamers, of our TPS recipients, and those and our essential workers who are undocumented immigrants, and those who would be eligible based on what we know of this legislation, both for an expedited pathway to permanent residence if falling within some of those categories, as well as a more lengthy but still pathway to permanent residence and citizenship. So, you know, our hope is that it is inclusive of, for the most part, that larger number, that outside number of about 500,000 New Yorkers, but certainly of our TPS community, our DACA community, and many of our essential workers. Anything you want to add, Yasmin, to that from what we know of the legislation?
Yasmin, we cannot hear you.
I think she said no.
Oh, she said no. Okay, great. Then that makes sense. My last question for my first round before I hand it over to council members, are the programs and the new processes that may not exist right now that need to be in place so we can assist newly eligible individuals. Has Moya thought about that? And can we work together to really build some of that out together?
Yeah, thank you for the question. I'll say a couple of things about efforts that we've undertaken to sort of look at this question. One is in doing the incredible research that the team did and analyses of understanding the legal permanent resident population that might be eligible to naturalize, we spent a lot of time thinking about that need and that effort and sort of what might be the right ways to sort of boost or increase the naturalization rates that the city has. This remains something that we're in ongoing conversations around. We've really appreciated conversations we've had with CUNY Citizenship Now and understanding their model and the way that it works, and certainly is one of the many goals or priorities that we introduced and published in the New York City 1NYC goals. as a recognition of how important we actually we believe and know it to be to the city. So that those efforts in understanding sort of the CUNY model and in increasing the rates of naturalization have continued. Additionally, we conducted an evaluation of NY citizenship in the last year to understand sort of what were the sort of positives and accomplishments of the program and how as we're sort of looking to fine tune and address or pivot it to be more efficient and successful, what are some of the learnings that we can build upon in all of these efforts? The third thing I'll say is, as you might recall, when we established and initially dedicated funding to Action NYC, it was in response to President Obama at the time's proposals around DACA and DAPA expansion. And so we feel very strongly that the program that we've established has proven itself. It's an incredibly successful program, one that has demonstrated time and time again its ability to reach New Yorkers and to do so in a way that is inclusive, is accessible, and yields tremendously high touch points and applications for our communities. And so we are certainly monitoring the legislative process, keeping our eyes and understanding on understanding what to anticipate and to expect, and looking at these various efforts on where we would need to build upon and where we could do so in a quick and efficient manner to be responsive.
Thank you. And as I ask other council members, if they have any questions, let me know. Otherwise, I'm going to keep going. I don't think we have anybody signed up yet. And so let me follow up, Commissioner, and remembering Obama's initial presentation and then the city's response. The city has been incredibly responsive to the winds of change at the federal level. And part of that was also the massive increase in deportations that we saw in Trump's administration. And the moratorium on deportations are going to impact how we respond. And so is Moya yet thinking through, and will they, could you work with us at the Immigration Committee and really with the City Council to rethink where all the funding that we have built up in support for our immigrant neighbors can be retooled and be in support of this new process that will be in front of us. And yeah. And I'm keeping it very general. I'm keeping it very general because I have some ideas, specific ideas, but I just want to see if we can very publicly let everybody know that we're going to be working on that together.
For sure. I'll start by saying we're, of course, not even a week into these proposals in the new administration, and we've already seen, you know, it's going to take a minute to get us on the right road and hopefully to realize some of these changes most effectively. We have internally begun these conversations about how to look at more broadly our landscape of legal services and to think about, as you said, a new moment and what it might mean to be responsive either by adjusting or increased needs that we may have. I'm happy to say that Yasmin is leading that effort for our office. Certainly as we begin this work, we hope to be able to partner with you all in the thinking and looking at the path forward.
Wonderful. And some of that might be legislation, but most of it will probably be budget. And as we anticipate the budget and the incredible tension and pressures that we're going to have in the budget, I think having a plan early that we can all digest and work on together will give it a, I think, the most kind of success, the best kind of success in partnership. So I'm really, really looking forward to that. And Councilmember Chin, I think you have a question too, but I'll hand it over to committee chair, committee council.
Thank you, okay. Councilmember Chin, you may go ahead.
Time starts now.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, commissioners. Great to see you. Well, my question is, relating to our seniors.
One of it is like, you know, how closely do you work with the Department for the Aging to help encourage more seniors to apply for citizenship? And the other thing is that in terms of the advocacy right now, correct me if I'm wrong, that in order to take the citizenship test in your own language, you have to be here for a long period of time. I mean, I think for what, 55 and older, you have to be here for at least 20 years. And 65 and older, you have to be here for at least 15 years. I don't remember the exact years for my advocacy day. But for seniors, I think if there's ways that we can advocate to shorten that time, because even though, you know, they struggle to learn English, it's not that easy. And they get nervous. And I know, you know, seniors who fail the test, you know, a couple of times. And if they weren't able to get the fee waiver, that's a lot of money. My question is that in terms of, you know, advocacy on shorten the period of time that for seniors who've been here so that they will have the opportunity to take the test in their own language where they will feel more comfortable. I mean, look, barely, you know, a lot of seniors could communicate with the basic English, but in a situation when they have to take an exam and, you know, they're asking them historic questions in order for the test, they get nervous or it's not easy to really learn all the specific questions. So that's one thing. And the second thing is that to really look at encouraging more seniors, older adults that are eligible to apply. And oftentimes, you know, the fee is a barrier, language is a barrier, and they might not have the assistant to help them, you know, like all the issue that the first panel raised, you know, traveling to take the test and all those barrier to help them sort of overcome. So, you know, that is my concern.
Thank you for the question. I'll start, and Yasmin, if you have anything further to add, please do. One of the things I wanna share is just the findings that our team produced related to kind of better understanding who the population that we believe are eligible to naturalize are in our city. And I think it's helpful to in somewhat being responsive to your question, council member. The average years in the US of an eligible to naturalize immigrant in our city is about 18 years. So it's an incredibly long period of time. Additionally, they are an older population with a median age of about 47. So recognizing and as I said in the testimony, we estimate that just under 60%, almost 60% of legal permanent residents that are naturalization eligible or potentially eligible are limited English proficient. So I think I just want to underscore based on our own analysis what you're sharing and the challenge that you're raising, council member. Further, I want to state that the work that we've done specifically that I spoke to with our Human Resources Administration in developing and creating a program that is very intentional and affirmative and reaching out to lawful permanent residents that are clients of HRA really does target that older population. These are folks who, by all accounts, are fee waiver eligible, low income, older, some who may have challenges as it relates to English, but who may, as you know, given their average years here and their age, be eligible for a waiver of those requirements and might not know that, right? So it's a very intentionally designed program to engage folks that we know and believe to be eligible or have a pathway for them to know what their rights are and how to have direct representation in carrying forward on those cases.
Time expired.
I'll turn to Yasmin maybe to build on or add to that. She's muted though. If we could unmute her, that would be great.
There we go. Thank you. No, thank you for raising that. I just wanted to add that there's no question that the barriers that that some of the barriers to naturalization under the Trump administration have had a disproportionate impact on seniors. So in particular, the changes to the disability exemption absolutely has, as has the changes to the exam, right? So some of the changes that we've seen have already disproportionately affected seniors. And so I think that from the, you know, from a policy side, that, you know, obviously we want to continue to push back against those changes and seek to undo some of the damage that has been done, while also seeking to create much more accessibility and rethink some of the arbitrary requirements to waive some of those exceptions that you noted earlier.
I guess one of the other thing is that in terms of the possibility of really allocating to push back on the number of years that you have to be here in order to take the tests in your own language. If we could shorten that time, I think that would be more helpful also to a lot of seniors. Like, why do you have to wait 20 years or, you know, just be able to take the tests in your own language? So I think that's something that we should be advocating to shorten that time frame. Thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilmember Chin. And the, I guess the real opportunity that we have here also in the council is to figure out how we can promote this larger agenda as well and join the mayor's office in that agenda. And so I look forward to working with you and other members of the committee to really force these questions that only I think New York City can with the power that we have and the long history that we have in supporting our immigrant communities, especially our seniors here in the city.
Thank you.
I have a couple more questions, or actually a few more questions. And for Moya, what is the interaction between Action NYC and New York citizenship? According to the Moya report of 2019, the annual report, the citizenship program was to be transitioned into the Action NYC model in 2020, and I think it was July, as part of the Action NYC in libraries, which will be more embedded into the city's legal services infrastructure through the HRA and Moya collaboration. And so considering that COVID-19 pandemic hit at that same time we were experiencing, what was the actual transition? What happened?
Yeah, thank you for the question and the opportunity to piece it together, because I think I've piecemeal given answers that speak to it. So we did continue and complete the RFP process for the Action NYC program during the pandemic, which is a very good thing. And we're happy to say that as of January 1st, our providers have been able to continue or in the event of new providers begin their work related to this program. I wanna sort of note that what our learnings were in the library model was that there was a lot of requests to the outreach workers at the library and to others to provide legal services that were more broad, so not just citizenship, a recognition that citizenship, while very important and should be a part of that program, shouldn't be the only service that was offered through those efforts. Additionally, NY citizenship was privately funded. If the committee recalls, it was a public-private partnership, non-baseline funding, and our goal was, as you rightly note, to ensure that we were institutionalizing both what was most effective about the work, but the continuation and importance of doing naturalization in an intentional and affirmative way. So we've done that in a couple of ways, bringing this fully into city-funded efforts while the private funding came to an end last year. So the first was in yielding savings of administrative costs in Action NYC and increasing those dollars through the RFP. And awarding Action NYC libraries to our new provider, which is the Immigrant Justice Corps, but continuing that additional support to libraries to undertake the outreach that, as I said, was such a critical and continues to be a critical component of that work. The second was recognizing that what was very unique about the program was the way we had embedded it into the Human Resources Administration and its ability to really reach the most vulnerable populations in a very targeted and affirmative way to move them through the process. And so we did, through the partnership with the Human Resources Administration this fiscal year, allocate city funding to that effort to continue that program in this fiscal year. Additionally, we worked with the Office of Economic Opportunity, recognizing that some of the challenges that you rightly raised because of the pandemic and the length of time that cases were taking necessitated the continuation of many of the cases in this fiscal year. So providing additional resource for that for this budget cycle. So that is sort of the long version of saying we're very happy to say that now this work is codified in city funding, that we were able to do that through the Action NYC work, but also to further realize it in HRE's budget this fiscal year to continue that part of the program. And that's something that we look forward to being able to continue to do.
Thank you. Thank you for kind of piecing that together. And it's a big feat, no doubt. And I think we'll hear from providers because I want to kind of get a sense about what else we can keep doing to build that synergy. But I'm going to move on to a couple other pieces that we wanted to accomplish in the hearing, which include fluctuations in the naturalization cases over the last few years. And the 2019 annual report talks a little bit about that Action NYC services provided for citizenship increased from 861 applications to 958 applications from 2017 to 2018. And then there was a decrease to 864 applications in 2019. There's a couple other more data pieces, but what do you think led to the decrease in naturalization applications between 2018 and 2019?
Sure, I can share my own thoughts, and Yasmin, please build on this with anything additional that we know or are aware of. But I think you've heard us speak numerous times to the challenges presented by naturalization in terms of the barriers that were lifted. I think very often you see in cyclical cycles that elections are a way to bring into people's awareness one of the many benefits of citizenship to be able to access. And unfortunately, what we saw in the last year were so many different barriers to citizenship were lifted up that length of time, you know, if say you were you started to think about and became interested in naturalizing at the end of 2019, it was clear you would not have completed that process for over a year. And so I'm sure without having research or analysis that points directly to it in front of me, that was one of the barriers. Additionally, and we've heard this across the board, just an increased fear or concern in enforcement being the priority of the previous administration, including looking at in a sort of more negative instead of welcoming way applications for things like naturalization. So in the past where there might have been less reticence to try and confidence that you will be able to go through because the system wasn't so designed to be enforcement focused or so punitive. Many may have been advised that this was maybe not the right moment to apply, but really the administration's intentionality to be trigger happy with deportation was one that perhaps wasn't worth it for individuals and their families and may have received advice to hold or to wait based on the facts of their particular case to hopefully a better, more sunshine oriented moment in our immigration system. Those are, some of what I surmise, both from what I've heard and read, are some of the reasons that we probably saw a decline in applications. But I don't know, Yasmin, if you want to add anything to that.
I
Yeah, I would just add that, you know, some of the barriers that have made naturalization applications more challenging under the Trump administration would create much more onerous systems for the legal service providers and for the applicants themselves, right? So the process that may have been previously somewhat straightforward of filing a fee waiver or filing a disability exemption have required much more follow-up by providers and advocates and much more document collection by applicants themselves, sometimes going back and forth numerous times with USCIS after having a fee waiver rejected erroneously, for example, right, by the agency, or having a disability exemption denied. So the work itself became much more onerous, which meant ending cases, and the amount of labor that took, I think also contributed to a decrease in new filings.
Okay, you cut out a couple points in the full testimony, but we'll follow up with you later to just get a better sense about how we can get that information. But I want to go to the next question, Commissioner. In really understanding whether or not Moya tracks successful completions of naturalization through Action NYC. And if you do, what are those approval rates of the cases that have gone through Action NYC? And let's take the 864 applications that were filed in 2019. How many of those were approved?
Sure, I can provide you what I have, and then if there's something that's missing, we're happy to circle back. So I want to start by saying that there are many programs, not just the two or three that we've mentioned here today, but others in the administration, including IOI, both the mayoral and city council funded efforts, as well as the CSBG, the community block grants, that support naturalization efforts. So we estimate with our Office of Civil Justice that there are approximately 3,000 applications for citizenship that have been filed in that universe of mayoral and city programs. And for Action NYC, as you note, in the calendar year last year, we estimated about 864 applications were filed. That doesn't include the number of folks that we engaged or that began processes, right? Who may otherwise be delayed or prevented from filing in this moment. It is literally the number of cases that were filed. And on average, we do collect the approval rates from our providers for the program. And we have about a 95% approval rate across the board. I don't know. I don't have in front of me the, actually, I do. thank you, team. The individuals granted citizenship in fiscal year 2019 were 700. And of course, given the delays from year to year, that's not an apples to apples number, right? Those could have been cases that were filed in 2019 that got adjudicated in 2018 or 2017 that got adjudicated in 2019.
Got it. Thank you for that. There might be some follow-ups, but we can keep moving. I think we're really interested in just understanding what's working, and as we want to partner in the retooling component and the funding conversation, this is going to be, I think, important. Including this next piece of information about the flow of the requests for assistance. How does Moya receive those requests for assistance with naturalization applications? Is it primarily coming through Moya hotlines or the Moya hotline or the Action NYC hotline or other referral services? So where is that coming in? And then once you get that request for assistance, where does Moya refer everyone to?
Yeah, thanks for the question. So there are a number of entry points that exist, everything from 311 to Moya's own hotline, to the Action NYC hotline, to directly to the immigration legal services providers as well. And depending on sort of the originating issue. We, Moya, sort of our best practice is that we direct to the Action NYC helpline. And the reason is because there you have the bigger picture view of what's available across providers and the ability to directly make the appointment so that folks don't have to sort of jump. They kind of have both options. You can go directly to the provider, but we're also able to make the appointment for you, right? We did create a system with the program with NY Citizenship last year in the libraries to be intentional about which providers were getting the citizenship requests first, just to more efficiently allocate resources in the right way. And so that was sort of for the helpline to figure out, the sort of a back end efficiency mechanism. And for NY Citizenship at HRA, they work directly with NILAG. So that is a direct communication with the provider and a handoff that's warm to ensure that the individual has the support from who will be eventually their lawyer right out the gate. So those are sort of the mechanisms that we utilize for those purposes.
Thank you for sharing that. I'm going to take a pause here and hand it back to our council. I think Councilmember Chin has a question.
Thank you, Chair. Turning to other council members for questions, we'll start with Councilmember Chin.
Time starts now.
Thank you. I have a follow-up question. In terms of, you know, outreach and letting people know that all these free programs are available. I want to know, like, as Moya and the advocates utilize the ethnic media outlet to really let people know that these services are available. Because one of the issues that we have faced is that, you know, oftentimes in ethnic community, you have these informal agencies or whatever that advertise and they help people with citizenship, and they do charge a lot of money, and then people, you know, didn't happen and got cheated and all those problems, oftentimes because they don't know that government, you know, or nonprofit have these programs that are available. So has Moya really looked at helping or putting resources to help, you know, utilizing the media, ethnic media, to really let the community knows that these resources and programs are available to help them?
Yeah, thank you so much for the question. We wholeheartedly, as you know, believe in partnering effectively with community and ethnic media. And so it has been a focus of ours to do so. We do it in a number of ways, not exclusively for immigration legal help, but immigration legal help and naturalization are always pieces of what we focus on in almost every communication that we have. So we have a news blast that we share with community and ethnic media with updates. We do regular community and ethnic media roundtables. We also publish op-eds in different languages that often get reprinted in community and ethnic media. And additionally, particularly on immigration legal help, we've done a number of things. One is partner with community and ethnic media for key or really important priority or critical announcements. So we've done that a myriad number of times around public charge and ensuring we're effectively reaching folks to understand sort of what does this mean and get legal advice before making any determination or decision as to their personal immigration case or status before withdrawing from benefits. Additionally, we launched last spring a Support Not Fear campaign, and the call to action there was around immigration legal help. That campaign we ran in community and ethnic media, both print, but also radio and television. And it's something that we are looking at reviving again this year, hopefully in the spring, And one of the calls to action, as I said there, is around immigration legal help. And so connecting people directly to our hotline to receive those services. So those are some of the ways that we do see community ethnic media as a really, really important channel to do outreach and get information out in a trusted fashion, but always welcome other ideas.
I guess the thing is, I mean, on a regular basis. So it's not like, an action here or a blast here in terms of, regular, weekly or something that, keep it out there in the media and the public, because a lot of the ethnic community, that's what they rely on, right? The ethnic radio, the newspaper. So I think that if something that the administration should look at, maybe putting some resources in there and not just only rely on, free advertising or just an article here and there, but regular kind of information that people see, because sometimes they missed it and then they don't hear it because there's still so many immigrants that's getting taken advantage of, especially with legal services and immigration. Unfortunately, that's what's happening in different community. And it's just so sad that people don't know about, fee waiver, citizenship classes, all these are available to them. And oftentimes, even when we try to publicize citizenship now, and it just, not that many people take advantage of it. And so I think that that's something that we need more resource to really help, get the word out regularly so that people can get this information. Thank you. So that will be in the budget, right? I think, Chair,
we
will have to look at
ESL
classes and, money for education outreach and all that to make sure that our community knows about all these good things that they should take advantage of. Thank you.
Exactly. And to your point, Councilmember Chin, and if you have any other questions, let's keep teaming up here in this hearing, because I think we're really revealing this honor of retooling our city agency responses, understanding the flow, the changes in the flow, the fact that we're going to be in COVID operations for some time as we get relief from the federal government. But the next question I had is not just about creating spaces like adult literacy classes and all that. There's also a lot of misinformation. And so how is Moya working with all the city agencies to combat the misinformation regarding naturalization applications from notarios and other predatory businesses and bad actors? We know that world really well. We combat that all the time. But in this new positive response from the federal government, we know we're going to have those bad actors come back. And so how are you working to anticipate that and to combat that?
Yeah, thank you for the question. So we are part of, as are many city agencies, the Protecting Immigrant New Yorkers Task Force, the Piney Task Force, that brings together stakeholders that share this interest in ensuring that we're effectively combating immigration fraud, including the Attorney General's Office, the District Attorney's Offices, the New York Immigration Coalition, and many other partners. And from the city, the NYPD, the Department for Consumer Affairs, and our team as well. And this is an issue that is really, really critical. It's one of the many reasons that we have together created a universal entry point that we can push out without confusion about where people can go for legal advice. And the fact that it's city-funded support and that people do not have to worry about the quality, but that the city is actually paying for incredibly high quality immigration legal help. We have worked to do a few different things to try and both elevate the concerns around this, but also to get information out about this issue, this really important issue. One is, our team developed a one-pager that we had translated into many different languages about how to avoid fraud. So what are some of the best practices? You know, some, sometimes simply saying, no, no, go here isn't the best answer for people, right? Maybe you want to go to the provider that supported somebody that you know or that's being recommended to you by a community member, which is often what we hear. And so we developed a best practice. So what to ask for in terms of contract, what to look for in terms of being a reputable legal services organization, right? All of the sort of telltales so that in our efforts to educate people, not just about the legal services that are available to them, but just making sure they know what their rights are and how to be a smart consumer in engaging with any immigration legal practitioner. So we've developed that. It's translated into many different languages. It's part of our efforts in getting information out and doing outreach about this work. We also held a hearing last year on immigration fraud, joined by our task force members to sort of hear and better understand the experiences community members and legal services providers have in this space to inform the task force's work now and in the future. And that will be a part of ongoing conversations through those efforts. And further, we, through the Action NYC hotline, which is a hotline that is operated by Catholic Charities, there's a back-end partnership with the Office for New Americans that receives many of these complaints. So that team is fully trained on this and has the ability without having somebody drop from the call to ensure that they're being handed off appropriately to report or share in any information about immigration fraud. But it is such an important issue and question. It is a very hard one to undercut given the import of getting relief that people feel and sometimes hearing no from a reputable provider about the ability to move forward in a case might make you desperate and go to somebody who's not so reputable and will take a lot of money in filing a fraudulent case, and that's not a good thing. So we really, really, really want to get good information out as much as possible. And one of the first things that I did last week when the announcement came from President Biden was to go on Univision and ask people to not go to any providers the next day, to be very clear that this was a declaration of an intention to go through legislation, but that nothing was yet available for folks. And so they might hear, come and we can apply for a pathway to citizenship, but that is a false and illegal conduct that should be reported. And our team has amplified that message in various channels as well.
I'm really excited to hear from the providers as well to see if there are any other ideas that can come from their work being on the ground. And to your point, and this just reminds me of DACA when it came out and there were a lot of questions about the application process and notarios were out and about and so many families were impacted, some communities more than others. I know in Sunset Park from our Chinese speaking community, we had a lot of issues that came out and so this is not new to us. And I'm really happy that you are kind of advocating for a responsible and thoughtful response from our immigrant communities. And I'm thinking about free tax return support that the city kind of puts together every year, and whether or not you're thinking about, or do you currently have anything in that form that can be really more robust in ensuring that people can have that support to pull those documents together as we anticipate a pathway. And what you might be thinking about in terms of creating something similar that can get rolled out so that people can connect to city trusted partners.
I'm not sure I'm appreciating your question, but I'll try to, and maybe it's because we haven't thought of it yet, but as you noted, the Department for Consumer Affairs annually does free tax prep, which is just a tremendous program, an important one that we partner in amplifying with them and have made sure that IDNYC can be used for purposes of accessing that program and sort of partner in the effort to get the word out. We have not thought about, at least I, not to my knowledge, ways to partner with DCAA, DCWPU actually now, to leverage that program or to build upon it in this moment. And certainly that's a conversation that we can have. We do know, I believe that, you know, they're all of their financial counseling centers remain open, are available to New Yorkers at this moment. I don't think any of that has been impacted in a way where it's shut down by the pandemic. So my anticipation without knowing more is that includes all of the efforts around tax prep that will happen.
And really it's creating a separate, but very much like tax prep, citizenship prep program that
I'm sorry, I misunderstood your point. Yes. yes, you know, this is part of what we had talked about and discussed in response to DACA and DAPA was in the creation of that program. And in the first year, I believe we operated it in this way. It also included a clinic model, like a tax prep model, for purposes of the application process. And given where things ended up with that effort, and of course with the Trump administration, it was retooled to be more responsive to the needs that we have. But in the very, very, very early conversations that we've had about looking at this new moment and what might be necessary, we have revived some of that, those initial thinking and points.
And again, this is another place we can partner in helping roll that out. And maybe the last comment I want to make, and if Councilmember Chin doesn't have another question, I just want to double check, yes or no? No, okay. We'll move on. And this will be my last comment for you, Commissioner, and your team who came here. Just thank you again for the work. And I know that we're all experiencing, no matter what, and where we are, this pandemic and public service it continues to be something that will be changing people's lives. And as we see this new administration bring life to something that we've been all fighting for such a long time, the local infrastructure is going to be critical to the success of this federal program. And we're going to have to meet them. And so it's going to require a lot of creativity. It's going to require new ideas and funding. And so this is not a budget hearing, but very soon we're going to have a budget conversation. And I hope we can work in anticipation for that so that we can retool and grow where we need to and redistribute where we need to ensure that we're getting as much support to what we need. And I think a lot about census and what we did together and the council bringing in a lot more resources to ensure that we can get to more people at a time where we could not knock on doors the way we wanted to and spread COVID. We were able to create new relationships with trusted partners. And so I think we're building upon a lot of really great infrastructure already. And so I have a lot of good feelings about that, and I welcome that partnership to bring all those learnings together.
That sounds great.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you.
I'm going to hand back to our committee council.
Thank you, Chair. At this time, we've concluded administration testimony. So thank you to Commissioner for testifying. We will now be turning to public testimony. I'd like to remind everyone that we will be calling on individuals one by one to testify, and each panelist will be given 3 minutes to speak. For panelists, after I call your name, a member of our staff will unmute you. There may be a few seconds of delay before you are unmuted, and we thank you in advance for your patience. Please wait a brief moment for the Sergeant at Arms to announce that you may begin before starting your testimony. Council members who have questions for a particular panelist should use the raise hand function in Zoom, and I will call on you after the panel has completed their testimony in the order in which you have raised your hand. I would now like to welcome our first panel. I would be in order. I will be calling on Anissa E. Drusadow, followed by Michael Mullen, followed by Benjamin Lundberg Torres Sanchez, followed by Min Sun Kim. Anissa E. Drusadow, you may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Hi, my name is Anissa Druzito. I am an adoptee. I was adopted in 1982 by Sergeant Major First Class Denver Druzito and my mother, his wife, Vicki Druzito. In 2003, I broke the law. I pled guilty to falsifying business records to the tune of $3,400 and change. In 2006, after my immigration lawyer, Monica Reed, died of an asthma attack, I was deported because I had no more money and no more support. I have been separated from my family since 2006. I couldn't afford to keep my daughter, so I had to send her back to the U.S. I get to see her every 2 to 3 years. Sorry. My oldest sister died of cancer, and I got to say goodbye to her in March of last year over a video call similar to this. Adoption promised me a family. They promised me a home. They promised me not to be thrown out again. This resolution is something that is a life-saving resolution and a life-saving bill once it gets introduced again, not just to me, to many deportees like Mike in Ethiopia, Mauricio in Costa Rica. I ask you guys to please help us not only with this resolution, but also when the bill comes in to urge Congressman Lazaro, please help us and to please get as much weight on this bill so that it can be introduced. I've watched 3 to 4 bills during my time out here go in and die, and I don't understand why. I did not ask to be adopted. I'm very thankful to be adopted because without adoption, I would have died from cancer. After getting adopted, I lost my leg to cancer, synovial cell sarcoma. The amputation was done in Walter Reed Medical Hospital. I am here with a prosthetic leg due to organizations in the U.S. I have running water, thank you, to Adoptees for Justice and their support that they have been for me and their platform that they had given me to have a voice back in the States, because without them, I would be silenced forever. I am not in hiding like most of the deported adoptees, because here in Central America, you cannot be very outspoken and let people know that you have been deported from the United States. I, on the other hand, this is all that I have. This is my only hope to be able to go home and not have to assist my parents' funeral through a video call like I am doing right now. I thank you all. I thank you, Chairman Menchaca, for the time that we have been given. Although I think 3 minutes is way too short for everything that I really want to say to you. It's not just me out here. It's many of us. And also in the U.S., those that are trying to retire and access benefits that they have paid into have been totally limited on what they have to do. Thank you so very much.
Thank you, Anissa, for your words and the connection to the human life that will be impacted by not just a bill, but by a change in mentality for our most vulnerable community members and the promise that is given to them. So thank you so much for that. And that is what's gonna go into this resolution when we debate it on the floor and pass it on the floor of the City Council and send that to Washington. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I will now like to welcome Michael Mullen to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Thank you, Council, for hearing us today. And we appreciate Councilmember Koo for introducing this resolution in support of the Adoptee Citizenship Act. I also want to thank Anissa for your strength. It inspires all of us to keep fighting for you. And so thank you for joining us today also. My name is Michael Mullen. I'm the current president of Also Known As. We're a New York City-based nonprofit, now in our 25th year of building community for international adoptees. If you ask any common person, you'll find 100% agreement that when a child is adopted, they become a full member of their new family, and they become a full citizen of their new country. So it's a little crazy that, it's like strange that we're talking now about this Adoptee Citizenship Act as a pathway to citizenship. these adoptees already had a pathway to citizenship. It was called adoption. And so it's just crazy that they're now being excluded from that. I think one thing that I just want to, you know, make clear is that this is really a clarification to existing law that should already exist. This is not like a new kind of carve out that we're trying to ask for, something that we're trying to get some special benefit. It's just a correction of unintended consequence of the way the adoption process works. It's really a bug in that process. Like we all have experienced, you know, bugs in the software. Like when we're, you know, I'm sure there's bugs in the software you're trying to use when you're trying to run your city council meetings. But and which can, you know, those are bugs are very frustrating and annoying, but this bug is destroying lives. It's breaking up families. Imagine waking up tomorrow and finding out that you cannot get a driver's license suddenly, and that you are no, you know, all your work, all your years of work, you suddenly cannot qualify for Social Security. Just very basic things like that. Much less, of course, victims such as Anissa, who have been deported very unjustly and denied their rightful citizenship. Resolutions have been passed in many cities such as Houston, Los Angeles. And so now we're asking for New York to be part of this country's leadership that will support the Adoptee Citizenship Act and bring justice for these adoptees. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michael, for your testimony today. And we want to join all those cities with New York's loud and important voice in that. And I also thank Councilmember Koo for this resolution and this committee for that work. And I also want to acknowledge that we've been joined by Councilmember Matthew Eugene from Brooklyn, member of the committee.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you for your testimony. Next, I'd like to welcome Benjamin Lundberg Torres Sanchez to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Good morning, City Council members and speakers. Thank you so much, Councilmember Koo. I really appreciate everybody's focus and attention so much today on considering accessibility. I also want to thank Anissa and Mike for your testimony and just express appreciation for time to speak today. My name is Benjamin Lundberg Torres Sanchez. I use they, them pronouns, and I'm joining you from unceded and occupied Lenapehonking, known to many as Brooklyn. I'm an arts educator who has worked in New York City public schools for 10 years and currently work with Pathways to Graduation students in New York City's District 79. I was separated from first family in Colombia for 28 years through a private transnational adoption process initiated in New York State. We know that adoption of foster care industries, as well as systems of family regulation and surveillance, like the administration of children's services, disproportionately impact Black and Indigenous families, immigrant families, and the children who are separated from those first families. My adopting parents are white, English-speaking, and wealthy enough to afford a lawyer to make sure that my paperwork was in order and that I was granted citizenship through naturalization. Of course, not all families have the means to have a legal expert aid them in this process. Despite all of these supports, and despite the fact that I was issued a U.S. American passport as a teen, I was erroneously classified as an illegal immigrant with the ability to work and was initially unable to access financial aid when I applied to college, requiring me to spend more time at Social Security Administration to fix this error. A relatively small impact for me, but of course, there are many more severe potential impacts that folks can face, including deportation, as Anissa mentioned in her own case. Just like our comrades who are DACA and TPS recipients, U.S. American citizenship is a huge support to our mental, emotional, and spiritual well-being, and as was importantly mentioned by the commissioner, is a support to our material well-being as well. The movement to guarantee citizenship for people separated from their families through international adoption processes should be undertaken alongside the fight to secure citizenship and other rights and protections for TPS recipients, DACA recipients, and their undocumented family members, whom are historically under-supported by policymakers nationwide. Given the many dynamics of choicelessness, displacement, and dislocation that adopted and fostered people face, the situation of being denied citizenship and its benefits only adds to the unnecessary obstacles within our lives. I'm calling on policymakers at all levels to act to redress this easily remedied issue. Thank you so much for the time.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Min Sun Kim to testify. After Minson Kim, we'll be hearing from Adam Lee Goodman. Minson Kim, you may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
I believe we might be having some technical issues, so we will turn back. I will now be calling on Adam Lee Goodman to testify. You may begin when you are.
Time starts now.
Thank you very much, Committee Council, Chair Menchaca, Committee Council Member Koo, and my previous panelists. My name is Adam Lee Goodman. I was adopted from South Korea, and I was lucky enough to have to be given citizenship and to have a family member, my adopted father, have the knowledge and the wherewithal to go through the process. But like Mike said, this shouldn't be about luck, right? And this shouldn't be, this issue is an issue of fixing a mistake. It's a bug in the system. It should be remedied because of the severe impact that stateless people have on their lives. And this isn't just an issue of citizenship. It's an issue of justice. And, you know, I appreciate all the time that we've been given, but, you know, and to hear this testimony. But, you know, we really need to get this done because we need to put these families back together and we need to sort of fix the mistakes that we've made. You know, I really don't have much more to add than that, but thank you for your time. And hopefully we can get this resolution passed and just continue to push this forward. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Min Sun Kim to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
I believe we're still having audio issues. In the meantime, I'm going to ask if Councilmember Menchaca, if Chair Menchaca has any questions for this panel.
No questions. Thank you.
Okay.
I want to say thank you to the panelists who are here. And again, we want to hear as many New Yorkers as possible. So I hope that you can stay, even if you have any technical issues. We want to make sure we hear your voice as we send all this testimony to and with the resolution.
Thank you, Chair. As a reminder for anyone who is not able to testify today, you can submit written testimony at testimony.council.nyc.gov. We're now going to move on to our next panel. So I'd like to thank this panel for their testimony. In order of testifying, our next panel will be Meetu Dhar, followed by Terry Lawson, followed by Alexandria Rizzio, followed by Sean Bloomberg, followed by Sarah B. Greenberg. Meetu Dhar, you may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Good morning, Chairman Menchaca and members of the Committee on Immigration. Thank you for inviting me to speak on this very important topic. My name is Neetu Dhar, and I'm the managing attorney for the CUNY Citizenship Now City Council Immigration Services Program. I'm here on behalf of Alan Wernick, our executive director. CUNY Citizenship Now started in 1997, providing free, high-quality, and confidential immigration services to individuals and their families on their path to U.S. citizenship. We have 8 centers located through New York City and are in 34 city council offices. Our partnership with the city council began in 2012, and thanks to the generous support of the City Council, we've served over 51,000 individuals and families at City Council sites and offices. Due to the pandemic, we've adapted our services to reach constituents remotely. Similar to Farahana Chowdhury and Ileana Diaz, who had testified earlier today, I began as a volunteer with CUNY Citizenship Now. This was about 10 years ago. I realized then there were and continues to be a large number of immigrants who cannot afford the cost of private attorneys and/or immigration fees. Because of this, and because they're unaware of other options, immigrants often have to turn to notarios or unethical businesses for help. These entities would take advantage of the immigrants' vulnerability and make false promises, which often resulted in the immigrants' removal from the United States. At CUNY Citizenship Now, we offer high-quality free services that provide another choice for immigrants. Our services eliminate the need for an immigrant to rely on these unscrupulous individuals and businesses. Until meeting with us, individuals that we heard from, such as Farhana Chowdhury and Ileana Diaz, were unaware that filing fees for naturalization can be reduced or completely waived. Fee waivers have made it possible for many to apply for naturalization. The Trump administration announced last summer that they would move forward with their plan to substantially increase immigration application fees and eliminate fees, eliminate fee waivers, especially in certain limited circumstances. This would have had a crippling effect on the poor and low-income immigrants and their ability to become U.S. citizens. In response to this, CUNY increased work and staff hours in order to assist more applicants before the deadline. Thankfully, the court blocked the administration from increasing fees and eliminating fee waivers. While some constituents are deterred by costs, others do not apply for naturalization because they're overwhelmed or fearful of the process, especially because of the last administration's restrictive immigration policies. CUNY Citizenship Now serves to alleviate these fears by providing information through our media outlets, Facebook Live series, and by speaking at various forums. The pandemic has had a debilitating effect on those applying for citizenship. Processing times for those waiting for naturalization interviews and oath ceremonies has increased. Further, just last month, USCIS made the civics test longer and more difficult to pass. There is a pressing need in New York City to continue and expand the services we provide. I thank you, Chairman Menchaca and the Immigration Council for inviting us to testify today, and I will be submitting written testimony. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Terry Lawson to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Good morning. My name is Terry Lawson, and I'm the executive director of Unlocal, a community-centered nonprofit organization that provides direct community education, outreach, and legal representation to New York's undocumented immigrant communities, including those seeking citizenship. This hearing is about reducing barriers to citizenship, and I want to take this time to talk about what New York City can do, and specifically what happened to our client, Javier Castillo Maradiaga, a Bronx resident who was in the news this weekend. Javier, a 27-year-old Bronx resident who came here with his family when he was 7 years old, was referred to Unlocal and the Rapid Response Legal Collaborative, which is funded by the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs, by the hotline operated by the Immigrant Defense Project. Back in 2019, Javier was stopped and frisked on a Bronx street by the NYPD. While in DOCS custody, Javier was unlawfully transferred to ICE custody by DOCS in violation of NYC detainer laws. After 14 months in custody, Javier's criminal case was finally dismissed by the Bronx DA in January 2021. During this time, Javier was unable to renew his DACA status due to being in ICE detention. Days before the inauguration, Javier was transferred from an ICE detention center in New York to an ICE staging facility operated by GEO in Louisiana. And told that he would be deported on Friday, January 22nd, on the second full day of the Biden administration. After Unlocal intervened, we were informed on Thursday that Javier's flight was canceled and that he would not be removed. The following day, Javier was informed by GEO that he would be deported at 2 a.m. today, Monday, January 25th. In response, we organized a rally and a press conference yesterday, and in the hours before the scheduled deportation, his mother, Alma Maradiaga, who is an essential worker in the Bronx, told reporters that she has not been able to hug her son or make him a meal in 14 months, a direct result of DOCS's illegal transfer of Javier to ICE custody. In late breaking news, we were informed late last night that Javier was not on the flight manifest for this morning, following intervention by Unlocal, Representative Richie Torres, Senators Gillibrand, and Majority Leader Schumer. And while we are relieved about this news, we know that much work remains. We cannot end the policing to deportation pipeline without talking about the historic, persistent, and everyday over-policing of Black and Brown communities. And we cannot talk about citizenship either without talking about that. We cannot talk about what happened to Javier without talking about what happened to Eric Garner, Amadou Diallo, George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, and too many others. What we've seen over and over again is that the criminal legal system and deportation industrial complex are not about public safety. These systems have deep roots in white supremacy and we have seen over and over again how they have been used by Trump and many before him to reinforce xenophobia and dangerously hateful racism at tremendous human costs.
Time expired.
As for what the city can do in the months and years ahead, we are calling for an end to the over-policing of Black and Brown communities, which means taking funding away from the NYPD, investing that funding into Black and Brown communities in the initiatives that they identify, and ending the criminal carve-outs in the detainer laws that continue to allow New York City to transfer people to ICE custody. Finally, Javier's mother told me yesterday that they have spent $20,000 in legal fees for herself and her family in fighting their immigration cases. She told me about her family, how her family was taken advantage of by unscrupulous providers, and how hard it was for them to find free, high-quality legal representation. Their case came to our attention just days before Javier was transferred to Louisiana. If the events of this past weekend have taught us anything, they have taught us that while the Trump administration is no longer in power, and there is a 100-day moratorium on deportations for some, the work is far from over. Deportation flights are still taking off every day, and unlocal and immigration advocates across the city are working tirelessly alongside immigrant New Yorkers to ensure that they remain here with their families. Javier is DACA eligible. His siblings have DACA. His parents have TPS. But they and 11 million others should have the full citizenship rights that you and I enjoy. We call on the City Council and the Mayor's Office to use all of its resources to make that happen. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Alexandria Rizzio to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Thank you to the council for convening this hearing and inviting the public to speak this afternoon. My name is Alexandra Rizzio, and I am a managing attorney at Safe Passage Project, a nonprofit legal services organization that provides free representation to immigrant children facing deportation. We serve children who live in the five boroughs of New York City and in the two counties of Long Island. No immigrant, not even a child, is appointed a lawyer in immigration court. If a child cannot afford to hire a lawyer, they will be forced to defend themselves alone against a trained government prosecutor and a judge, with deportation back to dangerous conditions as the likely outcome. Safe Passage Project helps correct this injustice by providing free attorneys to kids. Beyond legal services, our social work team addresses the broader needs of clients, such as school enrollment, homelessness, access to healthcare, psychological services, and public benefits. The New York City Council is instrumental in our work. You fund our work through the Unaccompanied Minors Initiative and the IOI grant stream. Without your unwavering support, which we've had since 2014, we would not be able to serve the over 1,200 clients that Safe Passage serves now. In fact, the City Council's support for the iCare Collaborative is groundbreaking on a national level and has shown that local initiatives that support universal representation for immigrants, essentially filling a gap where the federal government refuses to act, is not only possible, but successful. Thank you. After four long years where our clients, young undocumented immigrants, were constantly at the tip of the Trump administration's spear, we are feeling some degree of hope this week. Of course, the New York City Council has long been a leader on immigration issues of legal representation in immigration court. We hope that in the coming years, we will witness a sea change. Our dream is to create a city where all New Yorkers, regardless of immigration status, can realize sanctuary. The topic of this hearing, barriers to citizenship, is a salient one. We are hopeful that the changes at the federal level will open pathways to our clients and their families. At the same time, U.S. citizenship is difficult to achieve, expensive, and roadblocks litter the way, even for someone with a straightforward case. The following are issues that the City Council can exert influence over and help correct. Over-policing of communities of color. Even a simple or minor interaction with police can derail a person's citizenship application. Policing in communities of color is truly the intersection of racial and immigration justice. This summer's racial justice protests have only highlighted the brutal and unjust way police treat peaceful protesters. Until the city reckons with the NYPD's legacy of violence, and until Black and Brown communities are no longer the subject of over-policing, young people will be caught in a dragnet that affects their lives, up to and including their safety in the United States. The City Council should work to reform policing in New York City. It is the right thing to do, it is overdue, and it will
time expired
citizenship. One more point is that naturalization applications are extremely expensive. To become a lawful permanent resident, the cost is over $1,000. Though fee waivers are sometimes available, the federal government under the Trump administration made it a point to limit the availability of fee waivers and increase the fees. The city council could establish a fund to assist low-income residents to help them pay for these applications. Thank you for the opportunity to testify.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Sean Bloomberg to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
My name is Sean Bloomberg. I am a supervising attorney in the Immigration Community Action Project at Brooklyn Defender Services. I want to thank Chairman Chaka for holding this important hearing today. BDS's immigration practice works to minimize the negative immigration consequences of criminal charges for non-citizens, representing people in applications for immigration benefits. We defend our clients against ICE detention and deportation. Our Immigration Community Action Program represents people in non-detained removal proceedings as well as applications for immigration benefits, including family-based adjustment of status applications, fare-based applications, U and T visas, special juvenile immigrant status applications, DACA, and related applications. The people we serve face many barriers to citizenship, including criminalization as a result of racist policing, inability to pay exorbitant filing fees, and language access. We elaborate on these challenges in our written testimony, but today I will focus on the criminal legal system as a barrier to citizenship. Broken windows policing and similar racist policing results in criminalizing even the smallest offenses. Mere arrests, even in cases that are later dismissed or resolved with a non-criminal violation, can lead to denials of citizenship as a result of inability to prove good moral character. Denial of citizenship based on having an open criminal charge or pending probation, deportability, or mistakes in a citizenship application resulting in denial. For example, I give you the example of Edward Connor. Mr. Connor is a 52-year-old legal permanent resident who was convicted almost 30 years ago of drug and prostitution-related offenses. Since then, Mr. Connor has not had a criminal conviction. He has worked as a buyer and window display designer for a clothing retailer for nearly two decades. He is deeply involved in New York's vibrant Caribbean American community, running a company that designs elaborate costumes for carnival celebrations in New York and around the world, and participating in cultural and educational events. However, because of his prior criminal history, Mr. Connor could not apply for US citizenship for many years, resulting in his being in a legal limbo. After a lot of advocacy last December, Mr. Connor was finally granted a pardon by Governor Cuomo. As a result, Mr. Connor is able to move forward with his life to apply for citizenship and visit his family abroad, finally unafraid of deportation. Without years of advocacy, Mr. Connor would not have been able to move forward in this way. Some important benefits of citizenship include enfranchisement, stable status without risk of deportation, the ability to sponsor family members, and travel freely. With the new administration in Washington, we are hopeful that pathways to citizenship will open up and want to make sure that people we serve are able to be included without the barriers of exorbitant language access and difficulty accessing legal services. BDS's immigration work is made possible through the funding of the New York City Council. As a result of these barriers to citizenship and the high stakes involved, there is continued need for funding for legal services, especially for affirmative applications such as citizenship. And we hope urgent and critical immigration reform happens rapidly at the federal level and more people become eligible for affirmative relief. Free immigration legal services will be more important than ever. Our specialization in the immigration consequences of criminal legal and family court systems is critical due to the higher risk applicants face of denial with any criminal or family court history. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify. I welcome any questions.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Sarah B. Greenberg to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Good afternoon, and thank you for the opportunity to present testimony. My name is Sarah Greenberg, and I am a staff attorney in the Domestic Violence Immigration Project at the Legal Aid Society. Legal Aid encourages the council to pass resolution number 1229 in support of the Adoptee Citizenship Act. Currently, a child born outside the US to non-US citizen parents can become a US citizen by deriving citizenship through adoption by one or two US citizen adoptive parents. The Child Citizenship Act, or CCA, simplified derivative citizenship for most children, particularly adopted children. From the time it went into effect on February 27th, 2001, it prospectively granted automatic citizenship to adoptees and to those who were under the age of 18 on that date. For adoptees born before February 28, 1983, their citizenship was dependent on whether their adoptive parents had taken the affirmative steps to naturalize them. The onus was on parents, but some never completed the process. Some adult adoptees, now 37 years old or older, bear the deleterious consequences. For those unaware that they are not US citizens, many find out when they are applying for a passport or are required by an employer to provide proof of their immigration status. They are unable to vote, travel, or obtain financial aid for college. More critically, without citizenship, adult adoptees are vulnerable to being removed from the US for criminal offenses or non-criminal grounds of deportability. As we heard earlier in Ms. Drusadow's heartbreaking testimony, this loophole in the CCA has resulted in the deportation of numerous adult adoptees to countries where they have no memory, relatives, or ability to speak the language, and cuts them permanently off from their US citizen families. The Adoptee Citizenship Act would extend automatic citizenship to intercountry adoptees who were older than 18 when the CCA came into effect and meet the requirements. Would-be citizens who linger in the CCA's loophole include those who form the fabric of our dynamic city. On Korean American Day in 2000, US Congresswoman Grace Meng stated on the House floor, "Today there are 35,000 adult international adoptees who are in the US without citizenship and are at risk of deportation. This includes thousands of Korean adoptees who are undocumented in New York." The Legal Aid Society urges the Council to pass resolution number 1229, ensuring that all intercountry adoptees are granted citizenship and enjoy the rights and privileges conveyed therein in the country they call home. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now turn it over to Chairman Chaka for questions.
Thank you to this panel. All of you represent so much of what we are trying to build in partnership with all of you who are engaging directly and providing services. Much of that provided through a financial funding mechanism, and that needs to continue. And there's no doubt through the conversations we just had with our commissioner that we're gonna have to do this together. And so the importance of this resolution and this larger conversation about ensuring that every New Yorker has what they need to break through the barriers, a lot of it is assistance, legal assistance, it's financial assistance, it's getting through the notarios that are gonna try to take advantage of our community. All of this is gonna be really important. And I think what I wanna ask all of you is the following. As you anticipate some of these issues, can one of you or two of you talk a little bit about how you're anticipating the flow coming in, how you're gonna feel it, and through what kind of mechanisms? And what I'm looking for are things that we haven't spoken to. And that's just really, I think, where we need to focus the conversation here are like, how are people who you connect with and are trusted partners in the community connecting with LPRs and other community members? How are you going to expect that flow? Does anybody want to take that?
I can start, and I'm sure others will join in. And, you know, I think the conversation for us right now at Unlocal is starting with DACA, right? Because so many people are reaching out to us, trying to apply for DACA, wanting to understand what their options are. Now that advanced parole is another option, being able to travel outside of the country to become a lawful permanent resident through their DACA status and then ultimately gain citizenship is a very real, we don't have to wait for new legislation for that to happen, right? Like that is a pathway now to citizenship. And so people are reaching out to us and we are doing our best to create community clinics throughout the city. But of course it's a capacity issue, right? All of our organizations rely on funding to be able to make those clinics possible, to be able to be in the community with people answering their questions. And of course, you know, I know that this hearing is about citizenship, but every time we meet with somebody in community, we are talking to not just that person, but their friends, their family members, their parents, and talking to them about what their issues are, what their barriers are. So we, you know, just as a quick answer to the question, we are doing our best to partner with groups on the ground. Of course, we're on the ground as well, about what it is that they need and trying to operate in a COVID world as best as possible.
And then, Chair, if I could just add to that, at CUNY Citizenship Now this week, we'll be actually holding a Facebook Live session. I think it's at 6:30 on Wednesday evening for the public, so they can have a better understanding of what Biden hopes to pass in anticipation of what they can maybe start collecting and what they can expect. We plan on having Zoom borough-wide events. So that's definitely going to help educate the public, because I think what we need to do is just make sure we're giving the correct information out to the public and then having them come back and make more specific appointments with us.
Thank you for that. And I think what we want to keep obviously talking and so that we can get to more panels in this discussion, I just want to really dedicate an open line of communication with all of you and maybe set up another conversational space so that we can talk through some of these things. Because the other thing that I want to lift up from the testimony that most of you really pointed to was that this liberation that we're trying to fight for in response to COVID and the incredible movement that Black Lives Matter brought to our attention, this intersection between what has happened with the criminalization of poverty and the engagement that so many of our institutions need to change. And what I just want to, and that seems really big, it's a national conversation, but in the city of New York, we have the opportunity to change that through this budget and bring justice to this budget. And so as a council member, I want to extend that invitation to work together to actually make that happen in the next 5 months as we finalize the budget. And how do we do that? And how do we shift funds from the carceral state and into our communities as we see opportunities come in for justice for so many immigrant communities that have been targeted and deported and those that we could save. We did it because of you and in partnership with you. So that's going to take a lot of courage. And we did not take that courage last summer. And that's just going to require more organizing and more work. And so I just want to be open about that, that I will be with you. And we're going to need the city council to make that happen. And that can't happen without you. And so if we are serious, let us work together. Let us build that power. And exercise it through this council. And we have that obligation to really make the connections about what we're trying to dismantle and what we're trying to feed in terms of finance, attention, restructuring. And that's going to take a lot of time. And we have months to do this. And so let's work on that together. That is all for me. Thank you so much again.
Thank you, Chair. I'd like to ask if there are any other council member questions at this time. Seeing no hands, I'd like to thank this panel for their testimony. Now we'll be moving on to our next panel. In order, I will be calling on Ravi Reddy, followed by May Lee, followed by Jihei Fisher, followed by Anika Chowdhury. Ravi Reddy, you may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Thank you. I want to thank Committee Chairman Chaka and Council Members Chin, Moya, Drummond, Eugene for holding this hearing and for previous speakers for humanizing this issue. I'm Ravi Reddy, and I'm the Associate Director for Advocacy and Policy at the Asian American Federation. Our organization represents a collective voice of more than 70 member nonprofits serving 1.3 million Asian New Yorkers. We want to first acknowledge Councilmember Koo's Resolution 1229, calling for the passage of Adoptee Citizenship Act of 2019. Part of the work that will need to be done going forward is acknowledging and remedying systemic faults in our citizenship and naturalization processes, especially as it comes to adoptees from other countries who deserve the benefits and security of citizenship. When it comes to our immigrant community broadly, restoring trust is critical. Overall, Asians make up 16% of the city's population. Approximately 7 in 10 were born abroad, and about 1 in 5 Asian immigrants may be undocumented in New York City. 96% of Asian seniors and 88% of our Asian small business owners are immigrants as well. And let's be clear, it's our immigrant communities who have served on the front lines and sustained our city's economy since the beginning of the pandemic. Nonetheless, many Asian immigrant New Yorkers are worried about what role their immigration status will have as they navigate already onerous appointment and vaccination processes. The city must prioritize language access and timeliness in this effort by supporting community-based organizations and utilizing their existing communication channels that have been built over the last year in many of our most vulnerable communities. And while we're on the topic of trust, the last president's public charge rule must go unequivocally. According to a study by Moya and DSS, Asian non-citizens disenrolled from SNAP benefits at 8 times the rate of Asian citizens after the proposed public charge rule was announced. The city must take proactive steps in conjunction with community-based organizations to validate and address concerns of community members who have been forced to make the false choice between becoming a new American and getting their next meal. From the Muslim ban to an increase in deportation rates to unjust restrictions on student visas and un-American restrictions on family immigration, the Asian American community needs all the legal help it can get. City agencies must prioritize immigration legal services, funding for CBOs with a track record of providing not only immigration legal services, but also case management services to connect community members to legal services. Without Asian CBOs' ability to provide language and navigation support, few people would be able to access these legal services at all. It's also high time for City Council to finally fund a community legal interpreter bank so those needing legal services and social services can access qualified interpreters across the communities of color, as well as worker co-ops, which will focus on the recruitment, training, and dispatching of qualified interpreters and increasing job opportunities for multilingual immigrants. Local Law 30 must also be fully and consistently implemented across city agencies. As many are frontline workers, immigrants shouldn't be the last to learn of critical safety and benefit information. And finally, as our immigrant community also bears a disproportionate burden basic need insecurity brought on by the pandemic, the city must increase investment in safety net programs such as community health centers and clinics and food pantries, in part due to the continued after effects of the previous administration's public charge assault. While Asian New Yorkers comprise at least 10% of the population in more than half of city districts, with the other half having some of the fastest growing Asian populations from FY 2002 to 2014, the Asian American community received a mere 1.4% of the total dollar value of New York City's social service contracts, a reflection of broader long-term trend. Processes must prioritize the community-based organizations who have the expertise, but might not have the capacity to monitor for and respond to RFPs they may be eligible for. It's a two-way street, and the city must more proactively seek out and support community-based organizations while our CBOs use the capacity they have to work within RFP processes as it currently stands. It'll be our CBOs who will be instrumental in restoring trust between our immigrants and our cities. We understand the city is in dire financial straits, but CBOs have led by example in how to spend city dollars effectively. And this moment presents an opportunity for this city council to show that New York City can still lead by example in protecting its most vulnerable. We at the Asian American Federation thank you for allowing us to speak and look forward to working with all of you to make sure our immigrant communities get the protections they deserve. Thanks.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome May Lee to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Okay, hi, good afternoon. My name is May Lee. I'm with the Chinese Progressive Association. I also wanted to thank the Immigration Committee and Chairman Chaka for having this hearing that is all about citizenship. So I'm with the Chinese Progressive Association, and we're based in Manhattan's Chinatown in the Lower East Side. We primarily serve the Chinese community there, but we are, and we run a citizenship program. But the citizenship program also serves Black and Latino immigrants, as well as Chinese immigrants who are, you know, who are in our area. We run the citizenship classes. We help the we assist students with citizenship applications, and we have held these group application events, you know, I guess a little similar to those like tax prep events where many people and volunteers come together, the trained volunteers who help with the applications. We have not tried to do this on Zoom yet. So we actually have, it's always been in person indoors. So we haven't done it since early last 2020. And I'd like to say that we have had it at many different community sites, including the public library, the local library. We partnered with one of the settlement houses, Educational Alliance, and Manny Kanner Center. And we also partnered with Chung Pak, which is a senior housing complex where everybody is at least 85 years old. All these events were also open to the public as well as the residents or participants of that particular organization or complex. So I just like to make I'm not gonna repeat what other people said, but just make a few comments from our experience. I think continuing education about public charge is really important. I thought it was all done and everybody knew about it, but today we still meet people who are hesitant to apply for citizenship, or citizenship applicants who are hesitant to apply for benefits, which they are eligible for, and it is because of public charge. You know, they're told, you know, they shouldn't do it, or they think they shouldn't do it. Just about the fee waiver, even though USCIS still offers the fee waiver and the fees have not yet gone up to $1,000 and the fee waivers are still there, it is still not within reach for many. Okay, so for example, if you're a family of two and your income is anywhere, if it's below $34,480, you can get a partial fee waiver or the full fee waiver. But if it's just $1 over that, you know, you pay the full price, which is $725. So I think that's still a lot of money and would, you know, it would be a barrier. So I'm not familiar with the fee fund that a commissioner, that the commissioner was talking about, but it certainly needs to be expanded.
I'm expired.
Okay. I'll submit the rest of my testimony.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome G. Hay Fisher to testify. You may begin when you are.
Time starts now.
I would like to thank Chairman Chaka and the members of the Committee on Immigration for the opportunity to testify.
Ms. Fisher, there is an issue with the audio. Is it just me?
No, not you, Chief. Not you, sir.
Everyone. Okay. I want to make sure that we hear your full testimony.
Can you hear me?
There we go. Yes. Thank you.
Time starts now. Go ahead.
You can begin again, Ms. Fisher.
I would like to thank Chairman Chaka and the members of the Committee on Immigration for the opportunity to testify. My name is Jihei. I'm the executive director at the Korean American Family Service. We provide social services to immigrant survivors and their children who are affected by domestic violence, sexual assault, and child abuse. All our programs are offered in a culturally and linguistically appropriate setting. 98% of our clients are immigrants, and some of them are undocumented. Over 95% of our clients' first language is not English and come from low-income backgrounds. During New York State on pause and throughout the COVID-19 pandemic crisis, KFSC responded to a 300% increase in calls to our 24-hour bilingual hotline. 88% were related to domestic violence and sexual assault and child abuse. Anti-immigration policies such as the public charge rule on our immigrant community caused devastating and tragic effects, preventing many from reaching out for help for fear of negatively impacting their future legal status in America. misinformation, lack of native language resources exacerbated the problem even further. Current policies do not account for immigrant workers who lost their legal employment status as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. These gaps result in uncertainty and fear of deportation as another hurdle to overcome in an already overwhelming and desperate situation. Furthermore, the sharp rise in anti-Asian bias and hate crimes cause additional layers of fear and trauma for the Asian American immigrant community who had to face both the deadly virus and risk of a racist attack anytime they left their home. Our immigrant survivors were disproportionately impacted and further traumatized by policies and responses that excluded them from emergency relief efforts. Many of our survivors are undocumented and are excluded from accessing unemployment insurance and all other income supports. They lost their financial means, resulting in loss of livelihood and unable to support themselves and their children. These consequences are exacerbated as they are ineligible for unemployment benefits and other labor protections by law from which they are excluded. Additionally, the immigrant survivors of domestic violence that we serve face re-victimization on the path to citizenship. Many of our survivors are without legal status, and their abusers use threats and fears of deportation to maintain power and control over them. Current laws do provide a path for some survivors to apply for
time expired,
but they have very rigid guidelines that require cooperation with law enforcement and other barriers that often are not available to our survivors. We need to expand protections for survivors of violence and enact common sense immigration laws that will incorporate and work with the nuances and complex situations presented by immigrant survivors of domestic violence, sexual assault, and child abuse. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Anika Chaudhary to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
I want to begin by thanking the Committee on Immigration, the Committee Chairman Chaka, and the entire New York City Council for holding this important oversight hearing on reducing barriers to citizenship. My name is Anika. I'm the Priority Area Specialist External Engagement at the Arab American Family Support Center. I'm honored to testify today alongside Asian American Federation on behalf of marginalized immigrant and refugee families throughout New York City. At the Arab American Family Support Center, we have dedicated ourselves to creating an inclusive haven for immigrants and refugees for over 25 years. While we serve all who are in need, we have gained cultural and linguistic competency serving New York's growing AMEMSA population, Arab, Middle Eastern, and Muslim and South Asian communities. Additionally, our team now speaks over 27 languages and over 30 different dialects. Although today's focus shows a step in the right direction for expanding citizenship for adoptees, there's much work to be done to reverse the effects of anti-immigrant policies and rhetoric. Immigration policies such as the public charge rule continue to cause angst among our immigrant community members. Many feel reluctant about enrolling in the services and benefits they need for fear of discrimination or deportation. We have received numerous calls and visits from individuals concerned about the implications on themselves and their family members, particularly those who are now being forced to decide between feeding and housing their families or seeking legal permanent status in the U.S., especially during this deadly pandemic. In light of the new Biden-Harris administration, there has been conversation about an 8-year pathway to citizenship for those currently living in the United States without legal status. Although we are hopeful to seeing such changes in federal policies, we urge the city to address the immediate needs of our immigrant communities. The chilling effect caused by the public charge rule continues to hurt our vulnerable immigrant communities, and changes at the city and state level are needed to protect them. AAFSC, alongside the Asian American Federation, requests that the city expand language access to our marginalized immigrant communities in a culturally and linguistically competent manner, keeping in mind that content in different languages must be translated in the correct dialect and tone. As Councilmember Chin mentioned, we would very much love to see ethnic media also being used to spread information. We also request that we continue to help mitigate the impacts of the disastrous federal policies like the public charge rule on our immigrant communities during the ongoing pandemic by spreading information to dispel the fear-based rhetoric and myths. We also request that we provide more legal defense funding to allow immigrant communities to reach out about their legal status and have access to their rights, remain with their families, and understand immigration laws. We would also like for the City Council to commit to supporting immigrants and refugees with trainings and additional resources. The Arab American Family Support Center is already working to educate community members about the implications of public
charge. I'm expired.
But with your support, we can amplify our impact. We thank you for your attention today.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Min Sun Kim to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Ms. Kim, I think you need to accept the unmute request.
Can you ask them to call on you? Wait, hold on. I'm going to just leave.
Hello?
Yes, we can hear you.
Oh, you can hear me. Oh, thank you. I'm so pleased to see all of you here to show your support to the adoptees issue. I'm Min Sun Kim, and first of all, I would like to thank Councilman Peter Koo for taking charge in this issue. His strong leadership made this possible. As the president of the Museum of Korean American Heritage, our mission is to preserve our history and heritage for our future generations. Furthermore, as the Nassau County Human Rights Commissioner, I believe that all human beings must be treated equally, regardless of gender, race, religion, or background. The foremost value of democracy is to take care of our most underprivileged community. I am here today to fight and support for adoptees to be able to live as proud citizens. Passing this legislation is a priority for this humanitarian issue. Thank you to everyone involved, and I sincerely hope all our efforts will bear fruit in Congress. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Anika Syed to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Yes? Hello?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Good afternoon. My name is Anika Saeed, and I'm the Outreach Coordinator at Turning Point for Women and Families. Thank you so much for the opportunity to testify today. Turning Point for Women and Families was founded in 2004 and is the first nonprofit to address domestic violence in New York City's Muslim community. Turning Point helps Muslim women and girls affected by domestic violence empower themselves and transform their lives through a wide range of culturally competent services focused on safety and self-sufficiency. To date, we have worked directly with over 3,000 women, adolescent girls, and children. One of the pressing issues affecting many of our clients, especially senior women, includes the lack of resources they need to acquire citizenship. Federal policies, including the public charge rule, have adversely impacted the future of countless people. Additionally, the public charge rule created fear, apprehension, and uncertainty for the immigrant community, made worse by the pandemic. Fearful of the public charge rule, many of our DB survivors and seniors we work with chose not to apply for benefits they are entitled to that would have helped them during the pandemic. It is our collective duty to ensure not only access to public benefits and citizenship, but to break the barriers that prevent our clients from applying in the first place. Our clients and program participants who are already challenged by their lack of security been further traumatized by the prolonged pandemic. The new policies that redefine domestic violence have actually reduced the scope of the crime and affect survivors directly. Due to suppressed reporting, few statistics on domestic violence are available, and a narrower definition becomes even more harmful, excluding a large number of survivors we work with, creating barriers, creating new barriers, and ultimately halting their progress. Public charge rolls and limits to citizenship through seeking asylum exacerbate the existing issues many immigrants face today, leaving community-based organizations with limited legal funding with few sustainable solutions. Elected and appointed officials who are passing laws must consider the detrimental effects of these policies on the immigrant community. Emergency Medicaid, cash assistance, and food stamps are all ways this nation fights against poverty, food insecurity, and lack of healthcare. Turning Point for Women and Families strongly advocates for fair access to these basic human rights. The issues affecting our community have materialized into something far greater than shelter and safety. Access to these benefits is limited when technology is inaccessible. We have seen through this pandemic the far-reaching effects of the digital divide. After the courts closed, many clients were limited to phone calls to agencies that would leave their concerns unaddressed. Sharing information over the phone to complete documentation for citizenship applications to applying for public benefits seemed taxing due to lack of information security. Clients who were close to leaving their abusers and senior women in the pipeline for citizenship now have to navigate this difficult road virtually. Community-based organizations like Turning Point for Women and Families are committed to teach English to our community members and help them become empowered and integrated in the society we live in. Our classes are an entry point for seniors to learn English, learn about their rights, receive counseling and emotional support, especially if they're facing elder abuse. We urge each of you on the committee to please do all you can to find the resources to support the work of community-based organizations who are doing so much with so little to meet the growing needs of our immigrant community and redirect the narrative to be inclusive of all backgrounds, races, identities, genders, and religions. Thank you so much.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now turn it over to Chairman Chaka for questions.
Thank you. And I just want to say thank you to this panel. I am thankful for a couple things that were really highlighted. And I'm thinking about the domestic violence that is also growing in this time of COVID and the separation that social distancing is requiring us and the barriers that are connected to that. And I wanna offer some opportunity to maybe come back and talk to the committee about what we can think through together to support you, but also to think about things that the city can do right now and engage in a different way. And I think that you heard from the commissioner that that the mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs is also potentially open. And in this larger conversation about shifting funds into COVID impacted communities has to be met with ideas that come from all of you who are on the ground. And so let's start that sooner rather than later. I think Ms. Fisher also mentioned the idea of a guaranteed income, universal basic income. And so I have sent in to the city council a legislative request to start building that. This will require everyone that's on this call to help push the council to begin a public process to build a piece of legislation that works and to create a framework and a pilot that could potentially focus on immigrants who are not able to access federal stimulus. And so the council can respond, but when there is public pressure. And so let's build that public pressure together so that we can address these issues that you are kind of speaking to, but that we have the power to and the real duty to respond. And the more information that we have from the ground, the more organizing we can do, I think the better chance that we have to actually get some of these things done. So thank you in advance and look forward to working with you all on those issues.
Thank you. And I'd like to thank this panel for their testimony. We'll now be moving on to our next panel. In order, I will be calling on Fernand Darnell, followed by Olivia Pearl, followed by Rana Stifel. Fernand Darnell, you may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Hi, yes, and thank you for having me. My name is Dr. Farnad Darnell. I'm an Iranian adoptee who was naturalized in 1978 by parents who at the time knew the process and whatnot. Right. I've also, I'm a sociologist who's done research on adoption identity. And so this issue that has come before us on the, on this resolution for the Adoptee Citizenship Act was brought forth to me by my friend and colleague who's also an adoptee, Rana Stifel. So I just want to bring attention to this because not only through Rana, but through her work with the Adoptee Rights Coalition, I've become a lot more aware of this issue that I actually had no idea that existed until just in the last few months or so. The importance that I want to bring to this is the fact of a sense of belonging, I guess, the issue of identity in terms of trying to have this in this legislation is a key to the adoptees feel like they have a land, that they have a place of belonging, and that this adoption policy has failed them. And so to pass this legislation means that they will have a sense of belonging in their country that they've called home for so long, and to make this amenable to them in this legislation, it needs to remedy that to be able to also make sure that there is a mental health component that goes along with going through this process of not being a citizen, of trying to fight through this whole process and legislation, et cetera, et cetera. So anyway, I don't have anything a lot more formal, but I just want to show my support both as an adoptee, as a researcher. I apologize for the background. As an adoptee and as a researcher, but also someone who I was young and going through this process, but now as an adult and knowing what it takes, their frustrations and share their frustrations. I want to make sure that their voice is heard through me as well. So anyway, thank you for your time.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Olivia Pearl to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
New York City Council members, thank you for having me today. And thank you, Council Member Koo, for introducing Resolution 1229, very important legislation that highlights the need for the Adoptee Citizenship Act, an inclusive bill that will grant citizenship to all adoptees, including those with criminal convictions. Since 1948, over 500,000 children have been adopted from abroad by U.S. citizen parents with the promise of a better life. Yet the adoptive systems have failed to protect the children that they intended to protect. Adoptive parents, agencies, attorneys, and the United States government are all responsible for ensuring that transnational adoptees have a safe place to call home in the United States. However, an estimated thousands of legally adopted individuals who were born before February 27, 1982 and raised in the United States, or those who did not enter the country as on an orphan visa, do not have U.S. citizenship and therefore are potentially subject to deportation. It is now our responsibility to ensure the safety and protection that citizenship grants to these adoptees and right a wrong that should never have occurred in the first place. It starts here with you today. My name is Olivia Pearl, and I'm here on behalf of Adoptees for Justice, an organization that empowers adoptee communities and fights for restorative justice for all adoptees, particularly those who are most vulnerable. I am a transnational and transracial adoptee, meaning that I was born in another country and that I'm not of the same race of my adoptive family. I was adopted from Russia as an 18-month-old into a loving white family. Prior to adoption, I was cherished at the orphanage. The women caring for me cried as they handed me off. My mom was able to hire a translator, Max, who spoke with me in Russian and was the only person who made me smile or laugh for the first few days of my new life. Many people incorrectly assume that babies do not notice or remember traumatic events. While I have compartmentalized so much of the trauma of being taken away, much of the resulting damage remains. In addition to coping with this stress, adoptees without citizenship are led to endure many other traumatic experiences navigating the United States systems. My mom had to apply for my citizenship, and I am here to tell you why all adoptees deserve this right. I do not have to live in fear of deportation. I have never been referred to as illegal. And when I go to vote, I do not fear that this will be the patriotic act that puts my existence in the U.S. in jeopardy. These are some of the more simple, less tangible protections that the United States citizens have the privilege of experiencing. Until I joined Adoptees for Justice, I took my citizenship for granted. I knew that milestones like voting were easily accessible to me as a citizen, and I never questioned it. Additionally, I have not had to jump through unnecessary hoops to do so. The Adoptee Citizenship Act will not just grant citizenship and a haven for all adoptees, but will provide well overdue dignity and hope for many. Citizenship for adoptees means safety, security, and the realization of our dreams here in the United States. Please, City Council members, I urge you to pass Resolution 1229. Do your part today to end this cycle of systemic violence and trauma for adoptees without citizenship around the world. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now welcome Rana Stifel to testify. You may begin when you are ready.
Time starts now.
Good morning. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak on behalf of impacted adoptees. I'm an adoptee from Iran. I was adopted at 2 years of age before the revolution in Iran. I was adopted into a family where there was abuse, neglect, and abandonment at 16, and I am one of thousands of adoptees who entered the foster care system. Today, I am stateless because of poor adoption policy and zero oversight by the State Department on my adoption. I was one of thousands who was left behind by the Child Citizenship Act of 2001. We were deliberately left behind because we were over the age of 18 when legislation was passed to give automatic citizenship to adoptees. And here we are 20 years later, still being left behind by politicians who chose to politicize this issue and turn it into an immigration issue when it clearly is an adoption issue. Why do we need legislation, you might ask? Because U.S. Citizenship and Immigration talked to me in 2017 about my case and threatened me with deportation to a country I left as an orphan. The officer never once showed any empathy or acknowledged that I was adopted. The conversation was nothing but scare tactics. She told me I could be deported. I find that hard to believe because I am legally adopted in a court in a state. And when do we deport Americans to Iran? She told me my former Senator Kamala Harris and Congresswoman Katie Porter of California could do nothing to prevent my deportation. She said one of my options was to turn myself in for deportation and go in front of a judge to plead for a green card. I'm an American and the daughter of an Air Force officer and prisoner of war. Again, I ask you, how can we deport Americans to Iran? Immigration spoke to me as if I had illegally come to this country. How did I, at the age of 3, get on a plane and fly into the United States? My entire life has been documented here as an illegally, I stress, legally adopted person. I am a taxpayer and I am denied the right to vote. This is how the conversations have been with immigration. This is completely unacceptable. We are adoptees. Why are we being pushed through a crowded and cruel system and paying thousands of dollars for the mistakes made by our parents, adoption agencies, lawyers, the State Department, and Congress? Our lives are being erased and endangered because of the lack of urgency. We can't get driver's licenses, real act ID, loans, healthcare, retirement, and we are at risk of deportation. New York has 3 known cases of adoptees who can't get driver's licenses today because of Real Act ID.
Time expired.
You chose to stand in solidarity with impacted adoptees and magnified our voices on this issue. And I thank you, we all thank you from the impacted adoptee community. We must continue to hold Congress accountable for this population who are being denied their rightful claim to citizenship. This is not the life adoption promised us. If you know an adoptee who is struggling and living without U.S. citizenship, please refer them to Adoptee Rights Campaign. We are the foremost organization advocating for legislation called the Adoptee Citizenship Act. This legislation died in the last 2 sessions of Congress, despite bipartisan support and 103 co-sponsors in the House. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I'd like to now turn it back to Chairman Chaka for questions.
Thank you, Harbani. And I just want to say thank you to everyone's strong testimony rooted in experience that not just the council needs to hear, but the federal government. And as the new federal government is installed and we have reached out to our leaders so that the new bill, which will have a new number and will move forward with the support of the city of New York, when we move this resolution forward, it will have your testimony behind it. It will have your courage and relationship to the cruelty of what needs to change. And so I just want to say thank you for your testimony today. What I know more than ever is that we are at our crossroads of how a city can support this national agenda, return to dignity for this larger conversation of a broken system. And this city is behind you. And so as the chair of the Immigration Committee for the last 7 years with this incredible committee and this incredible council, we have been pushing with you and working with the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs. And so but our journey is not over. In fact, I think we have only seen the intensity and the impact of what Ms. Diaz has talked about and so many others that we've heard from today. So I want to just say thank you for that courage and that strength to be here. And we are listening and we will be moving forward with you to ensure that our federal leaders from the Senate to our local representatives have this resolution. And as we speak on behalf of New Yorkers, move to address this. So thank you.
Thank you, Chair. At this point, we have concluded public testimony. If we have inadvertently missed anyone that has registered to testify today and has yet to be called, please use the Zoom raise hand function now, and you will be called out in the order that your hand has been raised. Seeing no hands, I'm going to turn it back to Chairman Chaka for closing remarks. Chairman Chaka.
Yeah, thank you. I want to thank all the incredible staff who have put this hearing together on the tech side, our Sergeant of Arms, and our committee staff that include Harbani Uja, Elizabeth Kronk, Cesar Vargas, and Lorena Lucero. I also just want to say thank you to everyone who's come on and spoken to this issue, not just the resolution, but this larger intersectional moment that we have to make some changes. We will be very shortly moving into budget negotiations, and I hope that we can unite to bring justice. The council needs to hear from you, and it is because of your voice here today that we need to continue to work to change the way that we fund the most critical and essential needs of our workers, our essential workers, our immigrant workers, and the communities that have been impacted by this broken immigration system. And so the city of New York has so much power in its ability to bring ideas, not just to the rest of the city, not just the rest of the country, but specifically to other municipalities. And so we will have to meet the federal government halfway. And that's through funding, that's through reorganization, that's through creativity, and that's through the stories that you have brought today that continue to encourage me to fight as hard as I can to use the bully pulpit. And so I am dedicated to that work. And so let's talk about universal basic income. Let's talk about changing the way that we engage you with legal services, free preparation for DACA, and more. Pipelines for citizenship. These are all things that we need to keep hearing. And when we think about domestic violence that is ripping through our communities, it is heavily impacting our immigrant communities. And those barriers I heard very, very clearly, we need to solve those. And so let's do that together. And so that is my commitment to you to keep working. Let's reach out and let's build those spaces so that we can organize. Thank you so much again. And as the chair of the Immigration Committee, I now call this hearing to close. Thank you.